Muhammad is and always will be the last and final prophet of Allah. He was a mercy unto the universe. Peace and blessings be on al-Mustafa.
نحمدہو و نصلی علی رسولہ الکریم، اما بعد، اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم، بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. برادرز اینڈ سسٹرز، آئی ایم منظور شیخ، دی ہوسٹ فار ٹوڈیز پروگرام. وی بگن اور پروگرام with the recitation of Holy Quran. Zikra Naik will recite before you Surah Ala. Zikra Naik.
أيها المستمعون الكرام، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. اسمي ذكرى نايك، والآن أقدم أمامكم تلاوة القرآن الكريم من سورة الأعلى. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى. سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله، إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى. ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى. سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا. قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى. بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى. إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
جزاك الله ذكر نائك. Now I call upon Rushda Naik. She will do the qirat of Surah Duha.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى. ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى. ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث صدق الله العظيم.
This was Rushda Nayak, Alhamdulillah. Now, I call upon Parik Nayak. He will present Islamic song, M-U-S-L-I-M.
1 billion strong all year long, pray to Allah even in Hong Kong. Can I be wrong if you read the Quran? God has never been changed since day one. Other we brag, say that we lack, but they don't know all the power we had. The power we had, the power we had. So Muslim, oh, don't you ever be sad. Take merry looks, go read their books. You'll see all the facts that our friends overlook. So always be proud, you can say it out loud. I'm proud to be down with the Muslim crowd. M-U-S-L-I-M, I'm so blessed to be with them. M-U-S-L-I-M, I'm so blessed to be with them. Don't know about you, I know about me. I'm proud to come rolling Islamically. Everywhere I see, even on TV, people talking trash about the way I be. But what they all hate is if you get great, 'cause you are the one with your heads on straight. Don't ever frown with your head looking down. If you read the Quran, you're the best in the town. You all have doubts, say we have no clout, but within a few years, see how we've come about. Come back to the scene, the number one deen. I'm proud to be down with the Muslimin. M-U-S-L-I-M, I'm so blessed to be with them. M-U-S-L-I-M, I'm so blessed to be with them.
Jazakallah, Farid. Now we have Rushda Nayak delivering a song, Islamic song, I Believe in Allah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I stand in the line and pray, and zakah I pay. I fast in Ramadan, 'cause I believe in Allah. I'm nice to my fellow men, I'm kind to my parents. My elders I respect, 'cause I believe in Allah. Watching over me, all things Allah can see. I want to be sure He's happy with my deeds. He answers me in prayer. When I call, He's always there. He helps me through the day. Yes, I believe in Allah. I love to hear the Adhan. I love my Deen Islam. I hope to go to Makkah. 'Cause I believe in Allah, I believe, I believe, I believe in Allah, I believe, I believe, yes, I believe in Allah.
Now, Rushda Nayak will deliver an Islamic song, Talk to Me About Muhammad, Peace Be Upon Him. I request the audience, especially for this song, please carefully pay attention to each and every word of this song. It will, inshallah, touch the strings of your heart.
It would be such a pleasure to have you come along with me. I accept your gracious offer of kindness and company. But as we walk along, young man, and as you help me with the load, I have only one request. As we travel down this road, don't talk to me about Muhammad. Because of him there is no peace, and I have trouble in my mind. So don't talk to me about Muhammad. And as we walk along together, we will get along just fine. I have only one request. As we travel down this road, don't talk to me about Muhammad. That man upsets me so, so much more than you could know. I hear of his name and reputation everywhere I go.
Though his family and his clan once knew him as an honest man, he's dividing everyone with his claim that God is one. So don't talk to me about Muhammad. And as we walk along together, we will get along just fine. I have only one request. As we travel down this road, don't talk to me about Muhammad. Thank you now, young man. You've been so really kind. Your generosity and smile are very rare to find. Let me give you some advice, since you've been so very nice. From Muhammad stay away. Don't heed his words or emulate his way. And don't talk to me about Muhammad. You will never have true peace, and trouble is all you'll find. So don't talk to me about Muhammad. Now before we part and go, if it's all right just the same, may I ask you, my dear young man, who are you? What's your name? Forgive me, what was that? Your words weren't very clear. My ears are getting old. Sometimes it's difficult to hear. It's truly rather funny, though I'm sure I must be wrong. But I thought I heard you say, your name is Muhammad. Muhammad. Ashhadu Allah. Ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Talk to me, Muhammad. Upon you I pray for peace, for you have eased my troubled mind. Talk to me, Muhammad. And as we walk along this road, we will get along just fine. As I travel down this road, I will get along. Just fine.
Jazakallah, Rushda, for a very impressive song indeed. Now, I call upon Sayyid Shah Hussain Qadri to deliver the welcome note.
Nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulihil kareem. Amma baad, I, Sayyid Shah Hussain Qadri, welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. It's an honor and privilege for me to welcome a world famous orator on universal brotherhood and comparative religion, Dr. Zakir Naik, Chairperson Manzoor Sheikh. I also welcome the staff and crew of IRF, Islamic Research Foundation, Bombay. I'm gratified by the presence of such a huge and enthusiastic crowd waiting patiently to know about the presence of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in world religious scriptures. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that all doubts prevailing in your mind regarding the topic are cleared. Thank you. Jazakallah khair.
Brothers and sisters, the presence of all of you in several thousands here is definitely an indication to me that you are all very eager to listen to Dr. Zakir. And therefore, I shall not take much of your time in introducing the esteemed speaker to you. I will only take a few words to tell you about him. Dr. Zakir, basically a medical doctor by profession, turned around completely and came out to serve the cause of Allah. His activities for the past two decades have brought a revolution in the field of Dawah. And to project the correct picture of Islam in its right perspective, Dr. Zakir has traveled to several countries in the world, mainly USA, UK, Canada, and many other countries of Europe. His zeal to project the Islam in its right perspective has brought laurels for him and cleared the misconception about Islam to many people. He resorted to creating a new field for Dawah by studying comparative religion and he studied many books on Islam and comparative religion. He calls himself most humbly as the student of Islam and comparative religion. He has also traveled to several cities in this country to deliver his talk and has been in the forefront of the Dawah activities. I take upon this unique opportunity to request him to deliver his talk on the topic Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the various world religious scriptures.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Al Rasulillah wa ala ali wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ma kana Muhammadun aba ahadim mirjalikum. Walakhi Rasulullah. Wa khatamin nabiyyin. Wa kana Allahu bi kulli shay'in alima. Rabbi shrahli sadri. Wa yassir li amri. Wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. My respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. The topic of this evening's talk is Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the various world religious scriptures. Many people have a misconception that Islam is a new religion which came into existence 1400 years ago. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the founder of this religion. In fact, Islam is there since time immemorial, since man set foot on this earth. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is not the founder of this religion, but he is the last and final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, which was sent for the whole of humankind. The glorious Quran says in Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 24, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَافِيَا نَزِيرٍ. There is not a nation to whom we have not sent a warner. Allah says in Surah Rod, chapter number 13, verse number 7, وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. And to every nation have we sent a guide. By name, there are 25 prophets of Almighty God mentioned in the Quran. For example, Adam, Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, peace be upon them all. There are no less than 25 prophets mentioned in the glorious Quran by name. But Allah also says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 164, and Surah Ghafir, chapter number 40, verse number 78, we narrate to you the stories of some of the messengers, of some of the prophets, of the others we don't. That means all the prophets have not been mentioned by name in the glorious Quran. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's a Sahih Hadith, which is mentioned in Mishkat al-Masabi, volume number 3, Hadith number 5737. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent about 124,000 prophets on the face of the earth. But by name, only 25 are mentioned in the Quran. But all the messengers that came before the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were only sent for their people. And the complete message which they brought was only meant to be followed in totality till a particular time period. All the messengers that came before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were only meant for a particular group of people. For example, Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was only sent for the Jews, for the Bani Israel. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 49, that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was sent as a messenger to the Bani Israel, to the children of Israel. The same message repeated in Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 6. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says to the Bani Israel, I've been sent as a messenger to you. And this same message is even repeated in the Bible. It's mentioned in the Bible, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 10, verse number 5 and 6. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, he tells to his apostles that, go ye not into the way of the Gentiles. Who are the Gentiles? The non-Jews, the Hindus, the Muslims. Go ye not into the way of the Gentiles. Enter ye not into the city of the Samaritans, but rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The same message repeated in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 15, verse number 24, where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I have not been sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That means, according to the Quran and the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was only sent for the Bani Israel, only for the Jews, for the children of Israel. But Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last and final messenger. I started my talk by quoting a verse from the glorious Quran, from Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 40, which says, مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَهَدٍ مِّ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَاخِ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمِ النَّبِيِّينَ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمًا. Muhammad, peace be upon him, is not the father of any of you men, but he is the messenger of Allah, and he is the seal of the prophets. Allah is all-knowing, full of knowledge. Because Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last and final messenger of Almighty God, he was not sent only for the Muslims or only for the Arabs. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have sent thee not but as a mercy to all the worlds, as a mercy to all the creatures, as a mercy to the whole of humanity. Allah repeats the message in Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 28. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. We have sent thee not but as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings and warning them against sin. But most of the human beings yet do not know. Because Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last and final messenger, and no other messenger, no other prophet is going to come after him, that's the reason he was not sent only for the Muslims or for the Arabs, he was sent for the whole of humankind. We Muslims, because we believe that the glorious Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the last and final revelation of Almighty God, whatever the Quran says, we believe. That's why we also believe that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last and final messenger, and we also believe that he was sent for the whole of humankind. But most of the non-Muslims in general, they do not believe that the Quran is the word of God. That's the reason they may not agree that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last and final messenger of God and was sent for the whole of humanity. That's the reason, to convince the non-Muslims, I'm taking the help and guidance of one of the verses of the Quran, which I consider as the master key for da'wah, for conveying the message to the non-Muslims. Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, Ta'alaw ila kalmitin sawa'im bainana wa bainakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. When we are speaking with different types of people, the best way is, as the Quran says, come to common terms as between us and you. So let us analyze what do the various religious world scriptures have to speak about Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So the non-Muslims, if they believe in these scriptures, which they follow, if it's mentioned in the scriptures, if they consider it to be the word of God, then they have to even believe in the message of these scriptures. Let us first discuss Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Hindu scriptures. The Hindu scriptures can be broadly divided into two categories, the Shrutis and the Smritis. Shruti means that which is revealed which is understood, which is heard. The Shruti, according to the Hindu scholars, is considered to be the word of God. And they are divided into two parts, the Ved and the Upanishads. The Sanskrit word Ved is derived from the word Vid, which means knowledge par excellence. And there are four types of Veds: Rigved, Yajurved, Samved, and Atharvaved. Though exactly when did these Veds come into existence is not known. But according to Swami Dayanand Saraswati, who is the founder of the Arya Samaj, he says that the Veds are 1,310 million years old. But the majority of the Hindu scholars, they say that the Veds are approximately 4,000 years old. In which part of the world did it first come is not known. Who was the person to whom it was first given is not known. In spite of all these ambiguities, it is yet considered to be the word of God, and it is the most authentic and the most highest scriptures amongst all the Hindu scriptures. The next in authority are the Upanishads, derived from the Sanskrit word upa, which means near, ni matlab down, shad matlab sit, sitting down near. When the pupils and students sat next to the teacher to acquire knowledge, it's called as Upanishad, which means knowledge which removes ignorance. There are more than 200 Upanishads, but the Indian culture gives a figure of 108, out of which some are picked up as the principal Upanishads. Some have picked up 10, some 12. Sri Radha Krishna has picked up 18 and written a book, The Principal Upanishads. The next type of scriptures are the Smritis. Smriti means that which is remembered. It means memory. The Hindu scholars say Smritis are scriptures written by human beings, by rishis. And they are next after the Shruti. The Shrutis are higher than the Smritis. They're also called as Dharma Shastra because they tell how a life should be led by an individual, by the community, and by the society. One of the most important Smriti is the Purana. Purana means ancient. It talks about the stories of deities, about the creation of the universe, about literature. And Maharishi Vyas has compiled the Puranas into 18 voluminous parts. One of the most important Puranas is called as the Bhavishya Purana. Bhavishya means future. This Purana speaks about the future. And it's mentioned in Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khand 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 5 to 8. A Malecha will come along with his companions from the desert, and his name shall be Muhammad, peace be upon him. And Raja Bhoj will give this Mahadev Arab a bath in the Panchgarh and will welcome him with honor and address him with reverence and say, "O pride of humankind, you have created a great force to fight against the evil people." This prophecy of Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khand 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, it says that a Malecha will come. Malecha in Sanskrit means a foreigner. He will come along with his companions, talking about the Sahabas, from a Marusthal. Marusthal in Sanskrit means a sandy tract or a desert. His name shall be Muhammad, peace be upon him. Raja Bhoj will address this Mahadev Arab with reverence and say, "O pride of humankind, we know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the pride of humankind, as Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Qalam, chapter number 68, verse number 4. Verily, thou art standeth on the highest standard of character." Allah says in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 21. "Verily, in the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, you will find a very beautiful pattern of conduct." He further says that he will collect a great force to fight against the evil people. And we know that was done by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This prophecy refers to no one but Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Some people may say that the Raja Bhoj mentioned in this prophecy was present in the 11th century, 500 years after Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and was the descendant of the 10th generation of Raja Shilavahan. These people, they fail to realize that like the monarchs of Egypt, they were given the title pharaohs. There were many pharaohs. There was not one pharaoh. Like the kings of Rome were called as Caesars. There was not one Caesar, there were many Caesars. Similarly, the kings of India were given the title Bhoj. So there was not one Raja Bhoj, there were many Raja Bhoj. So this Raja Bhoj is not the one they're talking about in the 11th century. It is much earlier before that 11th century. Further, it's mentioned in Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 10 to 27. The land of the Malechyas has been spoiled. There was an enemy who was killed earlier. Now he's been sent by a more powerful enemy. I will send a man by the name Muhammad, peace be upon him, to guide these people to the straight path. O Raja Bhoj, you need not go to the land of the Pishachas, because I, through my kindness, will purify you where you are. Then a man with an angelic disposition comes to Raja and tells him that Arya Dharma will prevail in this world. I have been sent by Ishwar Paramatma. My follower shall be circumcised, who doesn't have a tail on the head, who will grow a beard, who will create a revolution, who will give the call for prayer. He will eat all lawful things. He will eat all sorts of animals, but will not eat the flesh of swine. He will not be purified by herbs and shrubs, but will be purified by warfare. He will be called as Musalman. This prophecy refers to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It says that my follower shall be a person who's circumcised. And we know the Muslims are circumcised. He will not have a tail on the head. That's a shendi or a chutki. He will grow a beard. He will create a revolution. He will give the call for prayer. That's talking about the adhan, like you Muslims give. He will eat all lawful things. He will eat all sorts of animal, but will not eat the flesh of swine. And Allah says in the Quran in no less than four different places. In Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173. Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 3. Surah Anam, chapter number 6, verse number 145. And Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115. Hurrimat alaykumul maitutu waddamu walahmul khinzir. Wama uhilla li ghairi Allah bi. Forbidden for you for food are dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah's name is taken. So because the Quran says in no less than four different places that flesh of swine is prohibited, we Muslims don't eat pork. The prophecy further says they will not be purified by herbs and shrubs, but will be purified by warfare, and they will be called as Musalman. This prophecy clearly indicates about the coming of the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It's further mentioned in Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khand 1, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 21 to 23. It says that the seven sacred cities of Kashi have been filled with corruption and rakshas. In the land of the Malechya, the followers of the Malechya Dharm are good people. All good qualities are found in them. And in this country, we find all sorts of vices. O Rishi, glorify the name of thy Lord. Here too, it is talking about Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and his followers. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is also prophesied in the Vedas. He is prophesied in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, mantra number 1 to 14. It is called as Kuntap Suktas. Kuntap means hidden gland in the abdomen. That means the meaning of these verses are hidden, and you'll come to know about it later on. Kuntap also means free from misery, also means peace, similar to Islam. It's also related to the center of the earth. And we know Makkah is the center of the earth. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 96, that the first place of worship was Bakkah, which is another name for Makkah. Time will not permit me to go through all the 14 mantras. I'll just briefly speak about the first four mantras. Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, mantra number 1 says, He is Narashansa. He is Kaurama, who has been protected from 60,090 enemies. Mantra number 2 says, He is a camel riding Rishi. Mantra number 3 says, He is Mama Rishi. Mantra number 4 says, He is Vashyavesh Reb. The first mantra says, He is Narashansa. Nar in Sanskrit means a human being or a man. Shansa means Prashansa, praiseworthy. A man who is praiseworthy, which is exactly the translation of the Arabic word Muhammad, which was the name of the last and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It further says, He is Kaurama. One of the meaning of Kaurama is a prince of peace. And a beloved prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a prince of peace. The other meaning is an immigrant. And we know Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, migrated from Makkah to Medina, and he was an immigrant. It further says, He will be protected from 60,090 enemies. And we know the population of Makkah that was against Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was approximately 60,000. Mantra number 2 says, He will be a camel riding Rishi. No Indian Rishi or a Brahmin will ever ride a camel, because riding a camel is prohibited for a Brahmin. It's mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 11, verse number 202, that a Brahmin will not ride a camel or an ass. Therefore, it has to be a prophet who is a foreigner. Third mantra says, He is Mama Rishi or Maharishi. Mama, some verses say Muhammad, some say great Rishi. Mantra number 4 says, He is Reb. Reb means one who praises, which is the meaning of the other name of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One who praises in Arabic is called as Ahmad, which was the other name of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also prophesied in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, mantra number 6. It says, it speaks about the battle of Azab, the battle of Allies, and it says that He will be protected from 10,000 enemies, and He will win the battle without fighting it. He will be a Karu. Now, Karu in Sanskrit means a person who praises. In Arabic, it means Ahmad, which is another name for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It says He will win the battle without fighting it. Talking about the Battle of Azab, which was won without fighting it. And we know the approximate population, the enemies at that time, were 10,000. It further says in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, mantra number 7, that Almighty God will overthrow 20 kings and He will protect the Abandhu from 60,099 enemies. Abandhu in Sanskrit means an orphan. The other meaning of Abandhu means praiseworthy, which is the translation of Muhammad into English, peace be upon him. So Abandhu in Sanskrit, if you translate to Arabic, means Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It says that Almighty God will overthrow 20 kings. And we know that there were approximately 20 chieftains in Makkah at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam won all of them. And the enemies against the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time was approximately 60,000. This same prophecy is also repeated in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 53, mantra number 9, but the Sanskrit word used is Sushrama. Sushrama also means one who is praiseworthy, which is the meaning of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also prophesied in Agni, mantra number 64, and it says that this Rishi, he will not drink the milk of his mother. He will not be breastfed by his mother. And we know Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not breastfed by his own mother. And Bibi Halima, may Allah be pleased with her, she was the one who breastfed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also prophesied as Ahmad, one who praises, in several places. In Uttarchik, mantra number 1500, In Indra, chapter number 2, mantra number 152. In Yajurved, chapter number 31, verse number 18. In Rig Ved, book number 8, hymn number 6, mantra number 10. In Atharva Ved, book number 8, hymn number 5, mantra number 16. In Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 126, mantra number 14. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, besides being prophesied as Ahmad, is even prophesied in several places as Narashansa. As I mentioned earlier, Narashansa is derived from Nar, which means a human being or a man, and Shansa comes from the word Prashansa, which means praise, a man who is praiseworthy. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is prophesied by name as Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as Narashansa in several places in Hindu scriptures. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 13, mantra number 3. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 18, mantra number 9. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 106, mantra number 4. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 142, mantra number 3. In Rigved, book number 2, hymn number 3, mantra number 2. In Rigved, book number 5, hymn number 5, mantra number 2. In Rigved, book number 7, hymn number 2, mantra number 2. In Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 64, mantra number 3. Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 182, mantra number 2. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse number 37. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse number 57. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 31. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 55. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 2. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 19. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 42. You can go on only giving references of the Hindu scriptures where Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is mentioned by name. Time does not permit us. You can give a lecture for a full day only on Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam Hindu scriptures. Due to limitation of time, I'll just mention one more prophecy about Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam Hindu scriptures. That is about Kalki Avatar. It's mentioned in Bhagavad Purana, Khanda 12, Adhyay 2, Shlokas 18 to 20. It says that in the house of Vishnu Yas, the noble-souled Brahmin, the chief of the village of Sambala, will be born Kalki. He will be given superior qualities and will be given 8 supernatural qualities. He will ride a white horse and carry the sword in the right hand. It's further mentioned in Bhagavad Purana, Khand 1, Adhyay 3, mantra number 25. In Kalyug, when kings will be like robbers, in the house of Vishnu Yas will be born Kalki. He's even prophesied in Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, mantra number 4. It says that in the house of Vishnu Yas, the noble-souled Brahmin, the chief of the village of Sambala, will be born Kalki. It's mentioned Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, mantra number 5. He will be helped by 4 companions to fight the evil people. It's mentioned Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, mantra number 7. He'll be held by the devatas or the angels in the battlefield. It's mentioned in Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 11. He'll be born in the house of Vishnu Yas, in the womb of Sumati. It's mentioned Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 15. He'll be born on the 12th day of the month of Madhav. In short, all these verses of the Hindu scriptures, they speak about the Kalki avatar. I'll just mention in brief the few points which is prophesied in the scripture. Point number 1, his father's name will be Vishnu Yas. Vishnu means God. Yas means the servant. It means the servant of God. If you translate to Arabic, it means Abdullah, which was the name of the father of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The mother's name will be Sumati. Sumati in Sanskrit means serenity, calm, peace. In Arabic, it means Amina, which was the name of the mother of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It says he will be born in the village of Sambala. Sambala means a place of serenity and peace. And we know Makkah was called as Darul Aman, means the house of peace. And Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born in Makkah. It further says he'll be born in the house of the chief of the village of Sambala, and we know Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born in the house of the chief of Makkah. It further says he'll be born on the 12th day of the month of Madhav, and we know Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born on the 12th date of Rabbi Awwal. It further says that he will be the last rishi, the last prophet, the antim rishi. And we know it's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Ahzab, chapter 33, verse number 40. Ma kana Muhammadun aba ahadim min rijalikum, walaki Rasulullah, wa khatam al-nabiyin, wa kana Allah bi kulli shayin alima. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not the father of any of you men, but he is the messenger of Allah and is the seal of the prophets. Allah is all-knowing and full of knowledge. So the Quran says that he will be the last messenger prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It further says that this rishi, this Khalki Avatar, he will get the knowledge, the enlightenment, the first one at night time in a cave. And then he will go towards north and come back. We know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first wahi he got was at night time in Gara Hira in Jabal Nur. And the Quran says in Surah Dukhan, chapter 44, verse number 2 and 3, as well as Surah Qadr, chapter 97, verse number 1, which says, Inna anzalna fi laylatul qadr. Verily we have revealed the Quran in the night of power. And we know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina, which was in the north direction of Makkah, and then he came back to Makkah. It further says he will be given extremely good qualities. It further says he will be given 8 supernatural qualities. The 8 mentioned in the Hindu scriptures is wisdom, self-control, revealed knowledge, respected lineage, valor, measured speech, gratefulness, and utmost charity. All these 8 qualities, alhamdulillah, are found in the last and final messenger prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It further says that he will be a messenger for the whole of humankind, as Allah says in Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 28. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَزِيرًا. We have sent thee not but as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings and warning them against sin. But most of the human beings here do not know. It further says that he will be given a white horse. And we know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the buraq by which he did the miraj. It also says that he will ride a horse carrying the sword in the right hand. And we know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam even took part in the battle, most of which were in self-defense. He actively took part and even had the sword in the right hand. The prophecy further says he will guide the ignorant people to the straight path. And we know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam guided the Arabs. Those days were called as Ayyamul Jahiliya, the days of ignorance. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the help of the Quran, he guided the Arabs from darkness to light. It further says he'll be helped by 4 companions, referring to the 4 Sahabas, the Khulafa Rashideen, Hazrat Abu Bakr, Hazrat Umar, Hazrat Usman, and Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with them all. And it says that he will be helped by the Devtas, the angels in the battlefield. And we know the Quran mentions in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 123 to 125, as well as in Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse number 8 and 9, that the angels helped Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the battle of Badr, and because of them, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was victorious. This was in brief talking about the Kalki Avatar, which is mentioned in the Hindu scriptures. For more details on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam Hindu scriptures, you can refer to my video cassette on this topic, which gives more details on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Hindu scriptures. Let us discuss the prophecy of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Parsi scriptures. Zoroaster was the founder of Zoroastrianism, also known as Parsiism. It originated in Persia about 2,500 years ago. It is also called as a religion of Meganism, or a religion of fire worshippers. The sacred scriptures of the Parsis are the Dasatir and the Avesta. Avesta is also called as Zend Avesta. The Dasatir is further divided into Khurda Dasatir and Kalan Dasatir. The Avesta is also further divided into Khurda Avesta and Kalan Avesta, also known as Zend and Mahazend. If you read these Parsi scriptures, in several places, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been prophesied. It's mentioned in the Avesta in Farvadin Yasht, chapter number 28, verse number 129, it says that his name will be victorious. His name will be Astvet Areta. He will be called as Soshin. It says that he will be called as victorious, as Soshyant. His name will be Astvet Areta. And we know Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was victorious in Fateh Makkah. And the word Soshyant, according to Hastings Encyclopedia, means a person who is praiseworthy, which is the translation of the Arabic word Muhammad. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is mentioned by name in the Parsi scriptures. It also says he will be Astavit Areta. Astavit Areta means a person who praises, which is the translation of the second name of Muhammad, that is Ahmad. Ahmad also means one who praises. Further, it's prophesied in the Avesta, in Zamyad Yasht, chapter number 16, verse number 95, that his friends will come, the friends of Astavit Areta, who will be fighting against the evil. They will be well-thinking, well-speaking, and well-doing, and their tongue will not utter a single falsehood. This is talking about the Sahaba, and the name again is mentioned, Astavit Areta, which means one who praises, that is Ahmad, peace be upon him, which is the other name of Muhammad. It talks about the Sahabas, that the companions of the Prophet will be good people. They'll be well-thinking, speaking good things. They'll be doing good things, and their tongue will never utter a falsehood. That means they will not tell a single lie. And we know from history that all the Sahabas, mashallah, they were truthful. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is also prophesied in the Dasatir, that is the other scripture of the Parsis. Dasatir means das, and atir means a book containing 10 parts. It is also plural of dastur. Dastur means a religious law. So it is a book containing 10 parts, a religious law. It's mentioned in the Dasatir, when the Parsis will forsake the religion, when the Zoroastrians will forsake the religion, and they will become desolate, a man will arise from the desert. His followers will subjugate the Persians and will conquer the arrogant Persians. They will be a mercy to the humankind. They will not worship the fire in the temple, but will pray in the direction of the house of God, of Abraham, which will be free from idols. They will be the masters and rulers of Persia, thus Balkh, and the other religious places of Persia, of the Parsis. And their prophet will be an eloquent person doing miraculous things. This prophecy also refers to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad. It's further mentioned in the Bunda-i Hash, chapter number 30, verses 6 to 27, that the Soshyant shall be the last prophet. Soshyant, as I mentioned earlier, according to the Hastings Encyclopedia, means one who is praiseworthy, referring to Muhammad. And it says in the prophecy, Muhammad will be the last prophet. This was in brief regarding Muhammad in the Parsi scriptures. Let's discuss the prophecy of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Buddhist scriptures. Almost all the Buddhist scriptures, they speak about a Maitri to come. It's also mentioned in Chikka Varsunar Setanta, D111-76. It says that another Buddha will come by the name of Maitri, the Holy One, the Supreme One, the Enlightened One, endowed with wisdom and conduct, auspicious, having knowledge of the universe. Whatever he will get from supernatural knowledge, he will preach to the whole world. He will preach a religion which will be glorious at the beginning, glorious at the climax, and glorious at the end. He will preach a way of life which will be truthful and wholly perfect. He will have several thousands of monks, as I have several hundreds of monks. This prophecy is also repeated in the sacred books of the East. volume 35, page number 225, that a Maitri will come with such and such criteria and qualities. And further it says that he will be a leader of thousands of people as I am a leader of hundreds of people. It's further mentioned in the Gospel of Buddha, page number 217 and 18, that Ananda, he asks Buddha that, "Oh, Blessed One, after you have gone, who will guide us?" So the Blessed One Buddha, he replied, that "I am not the first Buddha in this world, neither am I the last. There will be another Buddha who will come, the Holy One, the Supreme One, the Enlightened One, endowed with wisdom and conduct, the auspicious, having knowledge of the universe. He will preach a good religion. He will preach a religion which should be glorious at the beginning, glorious at the climax, and glorious at the end. He will teach a religion which will be based on truth and will be a perfect way of life. And he will have many thousands of disciples as I have only hundreds of disciples." The Ananda asks Buddha, the Blessed One, "How will we know him?" So Buddha replies, "He will be called as Maitri." Maitri means the merciful, loving, kind, compassionate. One equivalent Arabic word is Rahmah. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, "Wama arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alamin." We have sent thee not but as a mercy to all the worlds, as a mercy to all the creatures, as a mercy to the whole of humanity. This word rahmah, mercy, and its derivatives are mentioned in the Quran no less than 409 times. And every chapter of the Quran, except for Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, begins with the beautiful formula, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. So the Buddhist scriptures, almost all of them, prophesies about the Maitri that is Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to come. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is further prophesied in the Buddhist scriptures, which is mentioned in the Sacred Books of the East, volume number 11, page number 36. Maha Parinibbana Sutta, chapter number 2, verse number 32, it says that as for the Buddha, there are no exoteric or esoteric teachers. And O Ananda, the Tathagatas, that means the teachers, have nothing like a closed fist. We cannot keep the knowledge to ourselves. It should be proclaimed. And we know Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whatever he received as a wahi from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, he proclaimed to the whole of humanity. And he told his disciples that never keep it away from humankind. Proclaim it and spread it. That's what's mentioned in the prophecy. There's nothing like esoteric or exoteric. Everything should be told to the humankind. It's further mentioned in the Buddhist scriptures, in the Sacred Books of the East, volume number 11, page number 97, Maha Parinibbana Sutta, chapter number 5, verse number 36. It says that as Buddha had a servitor by the name of Ananda, so shall the Maitri have a servitor. And we know from history, from the Sirat of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that the servitor of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, radhiyallahu anhu, who was the son of Malik, may Allah be pleased with him. And Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that my parents gave me to the Prophet at the age of 8. And his mother told the Prophet, "O Messenger of Allah, take this to be your servant." And Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that the Prophet referred to him as his son, or the little beloved one. And we know Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he always stood by the Prophet in times of peace and in times of war, in times of safety, in times of danger. He can very well be compared to Ananda. We know when the mad elephant rushes at Buddha, Ananda stood by Buddha. Similarly, we know Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, in the Battle of Uhud, at the age of 11, even when the enemies were close to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, stood by the Prophet. Even in the Battle of Hunain, at the age of 16, when the enemies who were archers surrounded the Prophet, yet Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he stood by the Prophet. He can very well be compared like Ananda when the mad elephant rushes at Buddha and Ananda stays by Buddha. So this is the fulfillment of the prophecy that the Maitri will have a servitor. It is further mentioned in the Gospel of Buddha, page number 214, that this Maitri to come, this other Buddha to come, will have six qualities. The first is, he will get enlightenment at night. Number two, he will become bright when he gets enlightened. Number three, he will die a natural death. Number four, he will die at night. Number five, when he dies, he'll become bright. And number six, once he dies, he will never be seen in the bodily form in this earth again. These six qualities and criteria befit no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad. We know that Muhammad, the first wahi he got was at night time. As I mentioned earlier, the Quran says in Surah Dukhan, chapter 44, verse number 2 and 3, and Surah Qadr, chapter 97, verse number 1, that the Quran was revealed in the night of power. It further says, he will be lit up. And we know Muhammad had become bright, he was enlightened. It further says, he will die a natural death. And we know Muhammad had a natural death. Point number 4, he will die at night. And we know from the hadith of Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, that she did not have oil in the lamp. So she borrowed the oil from the neighbor, indicating it was night when Prophet Muhammad died. It further says that he will become bright at the time of death. And Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, says that Prophet Muhammad looked bright when he died. And the last point is that when he dies, he will never be seen in the bodily form on this earth. I know Muhammad, when he died in the bodily form, he's buried in Medina, and he was never seen in bodily form again. All these criteria mentioned in the Buddhist scriptures befit no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad. It's further mentioned in the Buddhist scriptures, in the sacred books of the East, volume number 10, page number 68. It says that the Tathagatas, they are only preachers. That means the Buddha has to come. They can only preach. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Ghashiyah, chapter number 88, verse number 21, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمْ أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. Allah says to the Prophet, your job is to deliver the message. Giving hidayah is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's further mentioned in sacred books of the East, volume number 10, page number 67, that to go to paradise, even your good deeds are responsible. Your good deeds are responsible for you to go to paradise. And Allah says in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1 to 3, Wal Asr, innal insana fi khusr, illa ladhin amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr. Which means, by the token of time, man is very in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deed, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. One of the criteria to go to Jannah is amal salihat, righteous deed, which is mentioned in the Buddhist scriptures. And further, it's mentioned in Dhammapad, Mattaya Sutta, 151. It gives the criteria of the Buddha, the final Maitri to come. It says that he will be a mercy to humankind. He will be gentle. He'll be an example to humankind. He says he'll be kind. And he will be truthful. So all these criteria befit no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad. This was in brief regarding Muhammad in the Buddhist scriptures. Let's discuss the prophecy of Muhammad in the Jewish and the Christian scriptures. The Jewish and the Christian scriptures, we know that the Bible is divided into the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Bible, according to the Catholics, has 73 books. According to the Protestants, they have thrown out 7 books as apocrypha, doubtful from the Old Testament. So total Bible contains 66 books. So the New Testament of the Catholics and the Protestants contain 27 books. But the Old Testament of the Catholics contains 46 books. Of the Protestant, it contains 39 books. The Old Testament speaks about the stories about the prophets that came before Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And the New Testament speaks about the life and the times of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We'll first discuss the prophecy of Muhammad in the Jewish scriptures. It's mentioned in the Old Testament. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 18, it says, Almighty God says, I shall raise them up a prophet from among thy brethren, like unto thee, and I shall put my words into his mouth, and he shall speak all that I command him. This prophecy says, I shall raise them up a prophet from among thy brethren, like unto thee, like Moses, peace be upon him. So the Christians, they say that this prophecy refers to no one but Prophet Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And when we ask them, why does it refer to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him? They tell us because the prophecy says the prophet to come should be like Moses, peace be upon him. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was like Moses, peace be upon him. And when we ask them, how are they alike? They tell us that Moses and Jesus, peace be upon them, both of them were prophets of God and both of them were Jew. That's why this prophecy is talking about Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. If these two are the only criteria for the fulfillment of the prophecy that he should be a Jew and he should be a prophet of God, then all the prophets mentioned in the Bible after Moses, peace be upon him, fulfill this prophecy. For example, Prophet Solomon, Ezekiel, Isaiah, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, John the Baptist, peace be upon them all. All of them were prophets of God and all of them were Jew. All of them fulfilled the prophecy. If we analyze, we come to know that this prophecy befits no one better than the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's analyze what does the prophecy say. The prophecy says, I shall raise them a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee, like unto Moses, peace be upon him. If we analyze, Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, both of them were born naturally. But Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was not born naturally. He was born without any male intervention. And this is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 45 to 47. And is also mentioned in the Bible, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 1, verse number 18. And the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 1, verse number 35, that he was born without any male intervention. He was born miraculously. Therefore, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is like Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, and Prophet Jesus is unlike Prophet Moses, peace be upon them. Further, if we analyze, Prophet Muhammad and Prophet Moses, peace be upon them, both of them were married and they had children. But according to the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was not married and he had no children. So Jesus is unlike Moses and Muhammad is like Moses, peace be upon them all. Further, if we analyze, Prophet Moses and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon them, both of them, they died a natural death. But Prophet Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he did not have a natural death. According to the Quran, we believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was raised up alive. Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 157 and 158. He did not die, we believe. Even if you read the Christian Bible correctly, even according to the Christian Bible, we can prove he did not die. He was not crucified. But the Christians think that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he died on the cross. He was crucified. For more details regarding this topic, refer to my video cassette. And the debate, was Christ crucified? But even if we agree for sake of argument, what they say is right. We have to agree that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he did not have a natural death. According to the Christian reading of the Bible, which is not correct, they believe he died on the cross. It was not a natural death. We believe he was raised up alive. Both ways we agree, he did not have a natural death. Therefore, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is not like Moses, peace be upon him. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is like Moses, peace be upon him. Further, if we analyze, Prophet Moses and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon them, both of them brought new laws. But according to the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did not get a new law. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 17 and 18. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, think not that I have come to destroy the law of the prophets. I have come not to destroy, but to fulfill. Further, if we analyze, Muhammad and Moses, peace be upon them, besides being prophets of God, they were even worldly kings. That means they could give the punishment of life and death to the person who deserved it. They could give the punishment of death to the person who deserved it. Where Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, he could not do that. And it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 18, verse number 36. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, my kingdom is not of this world. And further, if we analyze, Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, both of them, their people, they accepted them as prophets of God as a whole. But Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, his people as a whole, they did not accept him as a prophet. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 1, verse number 11, that they all forsook him. So here when we analyze, we come to know that Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, are alike. And Moses and Jesus, peace be upon them, they are unlike. So this prophecy refers to no one but Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The prophecy further says, I shall raise them, a prophet, from among thy brethren. And we know that the Arabs are the cousins of the Jews. Moses was a Jew, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an Arab. Peace be upon them both. So Arabs and Jews are cousins. Furthermore, the prophecy says, I shall raise them a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, and I shall put my words into his mouth, and he shall say all that I command him. We know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to get the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and used to repeat verbatim whatever was revealed to him. It was as though words were put in his mouth and used to repeat whatever Almighty God used to say. So this prophecy refers to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The next verse further says in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 19, it says that if you hearken not unto my words, I will require of thee, or I will take revenge. That means all those who do not hearken unto the words of this messenger to come, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Almighty God will take revenge. It's further mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 29, verse number 12. It says that the book shall be given to him who is not learned. The book shall be given to a prophet who is not learned. And when it is said, read this, I pray thee, he will say, I am not learned. And we know that when the first wahi came to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when Archangel Gabriel said, Ikra, read, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, Ma ana biqari, which means I have not learned. This is the verbatim fulfillment of the prophecy of the book of Isaiah, chapter 29, verse number 12, that when the book is given to the person who is unlearned, we know Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was unlettered, he was an ummi, and when it would be said to him, read, he will say, I am not learned. And that's what he said, Ma ana biqari. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is also mentioned by name in the Old Testament. It's mentioned in the Song of Solomon, chapter number 5, verse number 16. It says in Hebrew, Hikku mumetakim vikulli Muhammadim zaydudi zairai baina Jerusalem, which means his mouth is most sweet. He's altogether lovely. He is my beloved. He is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. They have translated Muhammadim as altogether lovely. But in the Semitic languages, like Arabic or Hebrew, they add im as a respect. Like to Elo, God, they add Elohim for respect. So to the name of Muhammad, they added Muhammadim for respect. Peace be upon him. So he's mentioned by name in the original manuscript. But now when we read, it's translated to altogether lovely. Now let's discuss the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the New Testament. As far as the Christians are concerned, whatever is mentioned in the Old Testament, they have to believe because that is part of the scripture, that's part of the Bible. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 157, they follow the unlettered prophet, which is mentioned in the law and gospel. It's further mentioned in Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 6, that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says to Bani Israel, to the children of Israel, I've been sent as a messenger to you, confirming what came before me and giving glad tidings of a messenger to come whose name shall be Ahmad. And when we read the New Testament, there are several prophecies of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the New Testament. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 16. It says, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, I shall pray to my Father to send you a comforter who shall abide with you forever. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 15, verse number 26. And when the comforter will come, whom my Father will send, he will glorify me. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the comforter shall not come. For if I depart, shall I send him? Many of the Christians say that this comforter refers to the Holy Spirit. Now, carefully note the prophecy of Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7 says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is saying, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the comforter shall not come. For if I depart, shall I send him. The criteria for the comforter to come is that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, should depart. Only if he departs, will the comforter come. We know that the Holy Spirit was there when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was being baptized. The Holy Spirit was also there before Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was born. He was in the womb of Elizabeth. Several places it's mentioned in the Bible. So surely this comforter cannot refer to the Holy Spirit. And furthermore, the word comforter, if you go to the Greek and Aramaic, the present scripture, it says it is paraclete. And they translate comforter. Paraclete actually means an advocate. And if you go and do research, the right word is parakletos, which means one who praises, or one who is worth praising, irrespective which is the name of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ahmad and Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, irrespective whether it is parakletos, the one who praises, or the praiseworthy, or it is paraclete, whether advocate or comforter, alhamdulillah, all these meanings befit no one better than the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Further, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hear shall he speak. He shall glorify me. He shall show you things to come. This prophecy says, I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, tells the people, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself, all that he hears shall he speak. You know, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whatever was revealed to him, he spoke verbatim. He shall not speak of himself, all that he hears shall he speak. He shall show you things to come. He shall glorify me. And you know, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has glorified Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, in the Quran and in several hadith. We consider Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, to be one of the mightiest messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was the Messiah, translated Christ. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern day Christians today do not believe. We believe that he gave life to the dead with God's permission. We believe he healed those born blind, lepers with God's permission. So Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did glorify Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. So this prophecy refers to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This was in brief regarding the mention of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the Christian scriptures. Time doesn't permit me to go and give more quotations, but this is just a nutshell, the tip of an iceberg regarding the mention of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the various world religious scriptures. I would like to end my talk with the quotation of the glorious Quran, where Allah says in chapter 108, Allah says, Inna aatainakal kawsar, fasalli labbika wanhar, inna shaniyakal walabtar, which means we have granted him the fountain of abundance, al kawsar, and pray to thy Lord and sacrifice the name of thy Lord. And anyone who hated thee, hated Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he will be cut off from all future hope. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallah, Dr. Zakir, for your very, very informative lecture today. Now, we come to the second part of our program, and that is question-answer session. The question-answer session would be conducted as follows. The mics are there at my left and in my front in the center aisle, and there is a mic in the ladies section as well. Those who want to ask questions may come to these mics and they can ask questions. First of all, questions that would be asked would be related to the topic, except to the non-Muslim brothers, who will have the right to ask any question that they would like to ask. The questioner has to give his name and profession. The question should be very short and brief, without going into any introductory speech. That would save time. I would especially request our volunteers to ensure that the person who comes to the mic is a non-Muslim. Now we begin our question answer session with a mic on my left hand. Any brother, especially non-Muslim brother, who would like to ask a question, may feel free to come and ask a question.
Respected Naik Sahab, my name is V. Balasubramaniam. I would like to ask a question. What is the definition of sin in Islam? What are the various kinds of sins? How is this definition different from that given in Hinduism, Christianity, and other religions? Thank you.
The brother asked the question that what is the definition of sin in Islam and how does it differ from the definition in Hinduism and Christianity? In short, sin means disobeying the commandment of Almighty God. If whatever Almighty God says, and if you go against it, it's a sin. For example, Almighty God says that you should pray. If you don't pray, you are doing a sin. If Almighty God says, don't have alcohol, and if you have alcohol, you are doing a sin. So disobeying the commandment of Almighty God, in short, is a sin. And this sin has a similar definition in all the religions, including Hinduism and Christianity. Hope that answers the question.
Question from the center mic, please.
Dr. Sakir Naik, I am Jerry Thomas. I am a research scholar in journalism at the Usmania University, and we and our friends run a site called sakshitimes.com. I have questions to you. One, I always knew that Quran is incomplete without hadith. Now you are referring to other scriptures also. Since you have referred to Bible says anybody who denies Jesus Christ is the spirit of Antichrist. That is a prophecy. And I also know that hadith says that Muhammad had diabolical inspiration. What should I conclude from this?
The brother asked a question in which he has mentioned a few sentences. He said that he knows that the Quran is incomplete without the hadith. And now he has heard other scriptures also. That means if I quote the Bible, that means I have to follow the Bible. And he says, the Bible says, anyone who does not believe and deny Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, will go to hell, etc., etc. So what are my comments? Point number one, the Quran is not incomplete without the hadith. The Quran is complete by itself. But to understand the Quran, you have to go to the commentary of the Quran. The commentary of the Quran is the hadith, that is the authentic saying of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Quran by itself is a complete book, alhamdulillah, by itself. But if you want commentary in more details about it, then you refer to the sayings, the authentic sayings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we call as Sahih Hadith. Now, just because I quoted the other scriptures, that does not mean I agree that all the other scriptures are the word of God. Please don't misunderstand me. I was using the strategy of the Quran. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse number 64, Ta'ala ila kalmitin sawa im bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. We are coming to common terms. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Ra'd chapter number 13 verse number 38, Wali kulli qaumin had, and in every age have we sent a revelation. Allah sent several revelations, several books. By name, only four are mentioned in the Quran. The Torah, the Zabur, the Injil, and the Quran. The Torah is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to Moses, peace be upon him. The Zabur is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to David, peace be upon him. The Injil is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And Quran is the last and final revelation which was given to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now, since all the previous revelations came only for a particular group of people and they were meant to be followed in totality for a particular time period, Almighty God did not think it fit to preserve it in pristine purity. But because Quran was the last and final revelation, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 9, we have revealed the Quran and we shall guard it from corruption. So Quran is the only religious book on the face of the earth which is in its pure form. I'm not saying that. Even the scholars of comparative religion, including William Moore, who's one of the staunchest critics of Islam, being a Christian, he said 200 years earlier that there is no religious book which has maintained its pure form for more than 1200 years. Now it is more than 1400 years, like the Quran. Being a Christian, being a staunchest critic of Islam, he has to be truthful that Quran in its pure form. Now all the other religious scriptures have changed its form, including the Bible. I don't consider the Bible to be the word of God. We Muslims believe in the Wahi, which was given to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, the Injil. But the present Bible that we have, brother, this Bible, it's a mixture. It may contain words of God, which match with the Quran. I've got no problem in accepting it to the word of God. It also contains the words of the prophets. It contains the word of historians. I'm sorry to say, it even contains pornography. I can't quote it here. I can't. It even contains hundreds of contradictions, scientific errors, mathematical errors, which I can't repeat here. But I had a dialogue with Dr. William Campbell. He wrote a book against Islam, the Quran and the Bible in the light of history and science. And he said, the Quran has got 30 scientific errors. I went to USA. He's from Philadelphia. And we had a debate in the year 2000, 1st April, on the topic, the Quran and the Bible in light of science. And I answered to all his allegations. And when I pointed out 38 contradictions in the Bible, he could not reply to them. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 79, Allah says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُلُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. Woe to those who write the book with their own hands and then say this is from Allah, to traffic with it for a miserable price. Woe to those for what they write. Woe to those for what they earn. So today's Bible, if you know, the word Bible is not there in the Bible. It comes from the Greek word Biblos, meaning a book of books. And the scholars say there are many authors of the Bible, not I, the Christian scholar. So the present Bible, I don't consider it to be the word of God. Similarly, if you ask me, can you consider Veda to be the word of God? Can you consider the Buddhist scripture to be the word of God? Can you consider the Parsi script word of God? What I say. Maybe they were not. Since there were many scriptures sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many books, by name Fora mentioned. But there were many other like Sufi, Ibrahim, several others. So what I say, maybe Hindu scriptures, maybe word of God. Maybe Buddhist scriptures, maybe word of God. Maybe Parsi scriptures were the word of God. But even if they were meant for those people and for that time. Today, you have to follow the last and final revelation, that is the glorious Quran. So any human being, whether you're living in India, in America, in Canada, in UK, in Singapore, in Saudi Arabia, all the human beings in the world should follow the last and final revelation, the glorious Quran, and the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I'm not saying Hindu scripture is the word of God. Even if it was meant for those people and for that time. The Hindu scholars agree that the scriptures have been changed. The Buddhist scholars agree that Buddhist scriptures have been changed. All the scholars of their own religion except Islam, they agree that the scriptures have gone changes down the line, down the ages. But even if I agree for sake of argument, it is the word of God. Even if it's, since the followers of that religion, they believe it to be the word of God, they should follow every letter, every word of the scripture. So if the Buddhists believe their scripture word of God, the Hindus believe their scripture to be the word of God, the Christians believe their scripture word of God, so all your scriptures are saying you have to follow the teachings of the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So since you consider it to be the word of God, I say maybe it is, maybe it is not. Since you believe it to be the word of God, you have to follow your scriptures. So you have to believe in the last and final messenger. As I mentioned in the Bible, in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hears shall he speak. He shall show you things to come. He shall glorify me. Who is this person? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Was there any religious person who has glorified Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, besides Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You rightly said that anyone who denies Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, will go to hell, you said. I agree with that statement. I agree. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And we have to say peace be upon him. You may say Jesus. I cannot say. I have to say peace be upon him. If I, as a religious person, if I do not add peace be upon him, I'll be kicked out. A layman can do that. I have to add peace be upon him. So, no Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern Christians do not believe. We believe that he gave life to the dead with God's permission. We believe that he healed those born blind and lepers with God's permission. The Muslim and the Christians are going together. But I know what you mean. When you mean believe in Jesus Christ, you mean? What do you mean? Believe is God, correct? Can you on the microphone? When you say believe in Jesus Christ, means what? Believe is the prophet?
I believe this statement that I am the way, the truth, and the life.
What does it mean?
It means that he is the incarnate God.
Brother has followed this question.
John chapter, the same.
I will give you the reference. I'll give you the reference also, no problem. What's the reference?
John chapter 14. You can refer.
Verse number?
I have the Bible, I can tell you. John chapter 14, verse 16. So,
not 16, verse number 6, it's not 16.
Sorry, Mr. Nayak, you don't have to teach me Bible. You just tell whatever. Your misrepresentations will be answered in our side.
That's right. Brother, you are not quoting, you have the Bible in your bag. Correct? You take out the Bible from your bag and you're quoting Gospel of John chapter number 14, verse number 6, it's not 16. And you said that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he said that he was God. I'll come to your question. Before I come to your question, let me tell you one thing. I've read the Bible. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me. If any Christian can point out to me a single unequivocal statement, a single unambiguous statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity today. I am not speaking on behalf of my other Muslim brothers. I am putting my head on the guillotine. I am a student of comparative religion. You have read the Bible, even I have studied the Bible. You say that I should not teach you the Bible. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, seek ye the truth, and the truth shall free you. I will, inshallah, show you the truth, and the truth shall free you today, inshallah. As I mentioned earlier, there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me. In fact, if you read the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself says, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 28. He said, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29. My Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28. I cast out devils with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20. I, with the finger of God, cast out devils. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, but the will of my Father. Anyone who says I seek not my will, the will of Almighty God, is a Muslim. Jesus Christ, peace be upon the Muslim. He never claimed divinity. It's clearly mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. It says that, ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you, by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. A man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. So the Bible clearly said that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a man. He was one of the mightiest messengers of God, but not God. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says, worship me. You quoted a verse to prove your point from Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 6, which says, where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto my Father but through me. Now, this is again quoting out of context. People pick up verses from the Quran and quote out of context to malign. Similarly, Christian missionaries quote the Bible out of context. I want to tell you a truth to you. You can open the Bible if you doubt me. Open the Bible. For the context, go to verse number 1. Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 1 says that, why are you afraid? Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, if you have faith in God, have faith in me. In my Father's mansion, there are many houses, and I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And when I go, I will tell you. So Thomas asked, where thou art going? He said, don't you know where I go? He said, no. Then he says that, show us the way where thou goest. So then Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, replies, I am the way, the truth, and the life. When Thomas asked Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, show us the way to God. Then Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, replies, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto thy Father but through me. We agree at the time of the messenger. Every messenger was the way, the truth, and the life. No man came unto God but through the way of that messenger. At the time of Jesus, I agree with the Bible that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was the way, the truth, and the life. No man came unto Almighty God but through the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. At the time of Moses, Moses was the way, the truth, and the life. No man came unto Almighty God but through the teachings of Moses, peace be upon him. But today, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to say unto you. Further, he says in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, I have many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hears shall he speak. He shall show you things to come. He shall glorify me. At today's time, the messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to Almighty God but through the teachings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Since Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last and final messenger, in today's age, irrespective whether a person is living in USA, in Canada, in UK, in India, in Saudi Arabia, any part of the world, for every human being today, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto Almighty God but through the teachings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And this is what all the major scriptures say, including the Bible. So hope now you have been enlightened to the truth, and hope, inshallah, you will come to the truth, and truth shall free you.
Now the question will come from the sister section. If any non-Muslim sister is there, please come to the mic and ask the question.
Good evening, sir. I'm a lecturer by profession and also a research scholar in Islam and comparative studies.
May I know your name, please?
I'm Neelima. I respect your great enlightenment, sir, but I have a small qualification to be made. Let us go back to the Bhavishya Purana, Part 3, Khand 3, Adhyay 3, and Slokas 5 to 8. Before going to this, I would just like to mention that maybe you already know, because every prophet who comes in the name of God will fulfill the prophecy which is made for him. So any prophet who fulfills 50% of that prophecy is not qualified to be a prophet. I mean, this is a simple logical thing. So now coming back to the Bhavishya Purana, you talked about the Malaysia leader saying that he is none other than Muhammad. Okay. Now, I accept the first half of the thing, of the sloka you said, but the second 50%, which is still ignored. Now, sir, let me tell you, Mlecha, the word meaning Mlecha, it is derived from Sanskrit dictionary, I mean the meaning, and the meaning means non-Aryan or sinner or wicked person. These are the three different meanings given to the word Mlecha. So, according to this, can Muhammad be a sinner or a wicked person? The second part is, the second condition of the prophecy is that he will belong to Marusthal, and in Sanskrit, land of death. Because Maru, I mean, it is derived from Sanskrit, Mru. Mru is death. And Definitely it does not quoting to the land of Arabia because it is a barren land or it is a battlefield. And next, coming to the third point of it, this prophecy also mentions that Dhatmanacha leader will take bath in Panchagavya and in river Ganges. And it is a common truth, we know that Ganges means Ganga river, and we all know that Ganga is not in Arabia, but it is in India. It is a universal fact. And coming to the taking bath in Panchagavya, the meaning of Panchagavya is five products of cow. And the products of cow is milk, curds, ghee, urine, cow dung. And now, sir, coming to this part exclusively, this prophecy must be fulfilled by Muhammad, wherein if you show me at least single reference from Quran wherein Muhammad has taken bath in either in all these five products, that is milk, curds, ghee, urine and cow dung, I'm ready to accept Islam today. Thank you, sir.
Sister has rightly said that if the prophecy that you give, if more than 50% is not fulfilled, then the prophecy is wrong. I agree with you, sister. I agree with you. And I will answer all your three queries. Let's see whether you accept Islam or not today. That's a different thing that you may not agree with the truth. I will speak to you. I agree with you. Malaycha, I agree with you, all your three definitions. Malaycha, one of the meaning is non-Aryan, meaning a foreigner. One of the meaning is sinner, one is a wicked person. That's the reason, like the Hindus, they call the Muslims as Malaycha. When they say that, they mean actually wicked and sinner. But the other meaning is also foreigner. As far as when I speak, when I quote from any scripture, while quoting and while taking the meaning, it's not necessary that if the word has got four meanings, then more than two meanings should be correct. No. Even if one is correct, the meaning is right. For example, the Quran says that don't have pig. Today, if you open the dictionary, one of the slang meanings for pig is a cop, means a policeman. So one meaning is pig. The other meaning is a policeman. But naturally, the Quran and the Bible, when the Bible says in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 11, verse number 7 and 8, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 8, and the book of Isaiah, chapter number 65, verse number 2 and 5, when it says don't have pig, it doesn't mean don't have a policeman. If you're a student of comparative religion, if there are 10 meanings, even if one is correct, you have to choose the right one. Two may be correct, three may be correct, all 10 may be correct. But even if one is correct out of 10, it can fulfill the prophecy. So here I agree with you, sister. Malaycha does mean non-Aryan. To Indian, it will be a foreigner. And I said in my speech when I translated, a Malaycha means a foreigner. Now you want to go in the wrong way and say Malaycha means wicked here. That is a misunderstanding, sister. If you say the Bible says and the Quran says don't have a policeman, that means you're not a student of comparative religion. You are a novice. If any one of the meaning fulfills the prophecy, one more thing. If there's a doubt, there are 10 points I mentioned. All the others can't be refuted. Your second meaning, Marustal. One of the Marustal, I do agree. Mar means death. But the other meaning of Marustal in Sanskrit is a sandy track. You go back to the dictionary today and open. In our Islamic Research Foundation, we have a Sanskrit dictionary also, sister. I am a student of comparative religion. I do agree. One is a place of death. The other is a sandy track. So why are you taking the wrong meaning? That means you're going out of the way. So if you see the permutation and combination, all the other points I mentioned are 100% correct. Here also, you have to choose the right meaning. So one of the meanings of Marustal means a sandy track or a desert. Coming to your third question. And you accepting Islam, inshallah. The third question that I mentioned in the prophecy, that Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam took a bath in the Panchgarh, in the Ganges. Now here we analyze that when we say in the Hindu terminology, when you say bath in the Panchgarh, in the Ganges, it means to purify. One means actually you dip yourself in the Ganges, which I don't expect the Prophet came and dipped himself in the Ganges. It means to purify. I did not give the explanation because the lecture is very long. I can speak on this topic for the full day. I did not give details of everything. I can speak on each prophecy for another few minutes, even for us together. So here, having a bath in the Panchgarh means purify. So depending upon the context, it doesn't mean a physical bath. And even if you physically have a bath in the Panchgarh, in the Ganges, not necessarily you'll be purified. It is the philosophy of the Hinduism. So here when the prophecy says that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, had a bath in the Panchgarh, it doesn't mean he came here in the Ganges. It means that he was purified by Almighty God. And we believe that all the prophets of God, all, whether it be Moses, Jesus Christ, peace be upon them, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of them were masoom. They were innocent. They were pure. So all the prophets of God, of Almighty God, which he sent down, all of them we consider to be innocent, to be masoom, to be pure. So this answers the question, and I hope, inshallah, you'll accept Islam, sister.
Now, question from the mic on my left-hand side.
My name is Prem Advani. I am from New Delhi, a retired senior citizen, non-Muslim. My question is that Islam, with a glorious past, should continue to be more glorious with a present time. I wish that the Muslims should give more transparency and access to what activities are being conducted from the grassroots level of madrasas and masjids and so on, so that the people should feel what is going on. The truth should be transparent. My name is Transparency. Thank you.
So that's a very good question. Before I answer the question, I would just like to throw some light. The sister had asked early question, three questions. And that reminds me that my daughter, who had come last, she had said a song, "Don't talk to me about Muhammad, you know, peace be upon him." And the coordinator said, "Please pay attention to the words, what she's saying." And if you heard the words carefully, it's the seerat of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that once when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going, he finds a companion as a stranger. She starts speaking against the Prophet. "Oh, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a bad person. Don't talk to me." She's telling Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that person doesn't know the person is talking to. She tells to the stranger, that person on the road, that Prophet Muhammad is bad. Don't listen to him. He causes disharmony. He teaches only about one God, blah, blah, blah. That's what my daughter was saying in that song. Later on, but she says, "Oh, you are a very good person. But I'm warning you, don't listen to that man, Muhammad, peace be upon him. He's a rogue. Nauz billah. He's a very bad person. Nauz billah." And so on and so forth. But she says, "You are a very good person. You are so kind. You are so loving. Please, may I know your name?" Then she says, "Pardon? What did you say? Am I incorrect? Your name is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam?" Then she says, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah." So when the traveler realizes that this person is actually Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, I have heard from other people that he's the wrong person, this person is so good, she immediately accepts Islam. So our dear sister, when she posed so many questions again, I thought it reminds me of my daughter when she was narrating the seerah of the Prophet in that song, the person, the traveler attacking Islam, attacking the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But when she comes to know the truth, she says the shahada. So inshallah, our dear sister also will share the shahada. And I really ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open her heart. Our dear brother here asked a very good question. He agrees that Islam had a glorious past, but he says that there should be transparency, especially in the madrasa. Who says no? I'm for you, brother. I'm fully for you. Who says there should be no transparency? Not transparency. I want the non-Muslims to come and study in this madrasa. I'm aware, brother. I'm aware what you're talking about the media. That the media is saying that madrasas are the schools of terrorism. Media says, not you, brother. Media. Madrasa in Arabic means a place of dars, somewhat like a university. You can call it a school, call it a college, or call it a university. But the media portrays as though, you know, if you go to a madrasa, you'll become a terrorist. Media portrays, not you. I'm asking, number one person who has killed maximum human beings in the world is Hitler. Which madrasa did he go to? Which madrasa? Which madrasa he went to? See, today, you know, mafia, the top people in the world from Italy and all these smugglers, if you take a survey that all the smugglers, all the top people that go to the jail, if you take a survey, how many people go to madrasa? How many?
a small, maybe a couple of percent, majority go to universities. Which university? Modern university, schools, colleges. So can I say that you should close the school? Can I say close the College of Education, close BA, close BCom, close BSc? No, because I know I have studied in the school. That school doesn't say that you should rob or you should smuggle, you should go against your country. It is they study in that school, but they are the black sheep of that school. So Hitler also may have gone to the modern education. I'm sure that the school he went to didn't teach him that he should kill 6 million Jews. So what we realize that these are black sheep. So as a whole, you know, every year in this country, there are thousands of people who are passing from madrasas, from Nadwa, from Deoband, thousands of them. So do you say that they're going and killing people? They're not at all. It is the media which portrays. And now the government wants to go. And last year or year before last, they went to Nadwa, imagine. They went to Nadwa and they wanted a search warrant they took out to check. To check what? And Alimiya Nadvi, Rahimullah, he said, okay, come forward, check. What they found? Nothing. See, once in a blue moon, one in a lakh, one in 100,000, one in 1,000,000, maybe a person after he passed the madrasa may have been misled. That doesn't mean madrasa teaches that. But a bigger percentage of the students studying from schools, modern education, from colleges, from university, which we get degrees of BA, BCom, engineering, doctor, more of the people doing wrong activities than evil activities. So as far as transparency, brother, I'm for it. No madrasa will ever say that you do not come and check. Our syllabus is open. In our school, we are teaching, mashallah, we are teaching comparative studies. My student from my school knows more about Hinduism than average Hindu. He knows more about Christianity than average Christian. He knows more about Islam than an average Muslim, because we pay attention to both of them. So as far as transparency, brother, is concerned, I'm for you, I'm with you, and no one will ever say that you don't come and analyze. Come, but don't blame. Don't come with a negative mind. Come with open mind. You may never know, you may get hidayah. You may come to the truth. Yes, brother.
Create an atmosphere of encouragement for non-Muslims to come and learn something and see for themselves. That is what I mean by transparency, so that people should not have suspicion that something wrong is going on, something good is going on. But you should make it transparent.
Brother asked a very good question. We should make it transparent for non-Muslim to come and study. Brother, first invitation I give to you and your children, come to IRF. I give invitation to you. See, Islamic Research Foundation has a library. It is one of the most well-equipped libraries, at least in India, of scriptures of different religions. You know, we have more than 200 different types of Bible, more than 50 versions of the Bible. We have more than 50 translations only of Bhagavad Gita. We have several translations of Vedas, of Rig Veda, Yajurveda, Atharva Veda. You may not find in the library of your government. You may not find in the library of maybe your school of thought. We encourage, study, and come to the truth. And leave aside others. I give the first invitation to you and to your children. I will even bear the air ticket free. Come to IRF and we welcome you. Study and we will learn the truth together, inshallah. Can you, on the microphone? Yes, brother.
I wish to thank you that you have taken my suggestion in the right spirit, and I will take opportunity to avail of your offer. Thank
please. Just write to us, I'll send you an etiquette, inshallah.
Yes, brother from the center mic.
My name is Ramakrishna. I'm a physiotherapy student. My question is, what is the need of Allah to create Adam and Eve and this total universe? What he will get from this? And my second question is, everything is created by someone. So even God must have been created by someone. What is the meaning of Allah?
Brothers asked three questions. The first question, why did God create Adam and Eve and what was his reason to create all this world and humankind? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam and Eve, may peace be upon them both, so that the humankind could come. They were the great, great grandparents. Allah says in Surah Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 13, Ya ayyuha an-nasu inna khalaqnakum min zakrin wa unsa wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila litarafu. Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum. Inna Allah alimun khabir. O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female. And I've divided you into nations and tribes so that you may recognize each other, not that you may despise each other. And the most honored in the sight of Almighty God is the person who has taqwa. The criteria to judge any human being, it is not wealth, it's not color, it's not caste, it's not creed, it is taqwa, it is God consciousness, it is righteousness, it is piety. So Adam and Eve, peace be upon them both, they were our great, great grandparents, of yours also and of mine also, all humankind. Therefore, I call you a brother. We are brothers in humanity. Allah says, Ya ayyuha an-nas, O humankind. And Allah says in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 70, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَا. Almighty God has honored all the children of Adam. Whether you are born in India, USA, UK, born in a Hindu family, or a Muslim family, or a Christian family, Allah says He has honored all the Bani Adam. If you are a human being, Allah has honored you. Whether your name is Zakir, Abdullah, Ramu, Shankar, if you are born as a human being, Allah has honored you. Now coming to the question, why has Almighty God created the human beings? Allah has created the human beings because Allah says this is one of His best creation. All the other creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they obey Him. We have the angels. Whatever Almighty God says, the angels obey Him directly. They have no free will. The human being is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has a free will. We can either obey Him or disobey Him. So Allah has created such a creation. We are one of His best creation and the best of forms. But we have a choice of either obeying God or disobeying God. If we obey God, we will go to Jannah, we will go to Swarg, we will go to heaven. If we disobey Him, we will go to hell, we will go to Nark. So this is a test for the hereafter. Allah says in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 2, Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It is Allah who has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. So this life is a test for the hereafter. So Allah has created the human beings, and Allah says in Surah Dhariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 56, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That we have created the jinn and the men not but to worship Him. So we supposed to worship, obey the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a different creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has the free will of even going against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or obeying Him. All the other things, the stars, the trees, the mountains, the Quran says they do sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They prostrate to Him, they obey Him. We have a free will. Now, when Allah has given a free will, with the free will, if we obey Him, we become higher than the angels. With the free will, if we disobey Him, we become the partners of the devil. So He's created us for the test for the hereafter. Coming to your second question. Everything has a creator who created God. If anyone says everything has a creator, it is a wrong statement. Every created thing has a creator. The definition of God is, He is uncreated. The moment you say who created God, He's not God. The definition of God is He's uncreated. Suppose a person comes and asks you, that brother, my friend John, he was admitted in the hospital. He gave birth to a child. Can you guess, was it a girl or a boy? Can you guess? Try it out. Guess. Can't guess. Why? Can you on the microphone? Can you guess, was it a girl or a boy? Huh? See, brother John, he was admitted in the hospital. He gave birth to a child. Was it a girl or a boy? Can you guess? A 50% chance? Girl or boy? People are laughing. Why? Can you guess? Can't guess. Why? Even if you guess, can you get the answer right? Achha, can you guess? I'll give you two chances. Was it a girl or a boy? Try it out.
Girl.
Brother, can a man give birth to a child? Ah, there you made a mistake. Same way you made a mistake by asking who created God. A man cannot give birth to a child. So where's the question of it being girl or a boy? See, now you understood. Ah, now that's good, brother. So it was, a man cannot give birth to a child. So where's the question of a girl or a boy? So when you're asking who created God, God by definition, Allah by definition is uncreated. The moment you say who created Allah, He's not Allah. Then nothing like Him. Coming to your last part of the question, who is Allah? Who is Allah? The best definition I can give you is quote to you Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4. It's mentioned in the Quran, Kul huwa Allahu ahad. Say he is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah the absolute eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not nor is he begotten. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There's nothing like him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any human being, any person says, so and so candidate is God. If that candidate fits in this four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that candidate as God. Four-line definition. This is the litmus test for theology, for the study of God. First is, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah the absolute eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not nor is he begotten. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There's nothing like him. If you go to the Hindu scriptures, the same is mentioned in the Hindu scriptures. Qul huwa Allahu ahad is mentioned, if you read Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1, Ikkam Evidityam, God is only one without a second. Second test, Allahu Samad, Allah the absolute eternal. Bhagavad Gita chapter number 10, verse number 3 says, I am known as the Lord of all the worlds, the unbegotten, the beginningless. Third test, Lam Yulad Valam Yulad, he begets not nor is he begotten. It's mentioned in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, chapter number 6, verse number 9. Nachas yakasij, janita na chadipa. Of him, there are no lords. He has got no parents. Almighty God has got no father. He has got no mother. And valam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, there is nothing like him, is mentioned in Shvetashvatara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. And Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3, where it says, Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima, there is no idol, there is no image, there is no photograph, there is no sculpture. Who says that? Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Same as Walam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. So any person saying so and so candidate is God, if that candidate fits in this four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that candidate as God. For example, some people say, Bhagwan Rajneesh is Almighty God. Once during question answer time, a Hindu told me, we don't believe Bhagwan Rajneesh to be God. I never said that the Hindus believe Bhagwan Rajneesh is God. I said, some people believe Bhagwan Rajneesh to be God. Let us put this Rajneesh to test. First test is, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say is Allah one and only. Was Rajneesh one and only? Was he the only man who claimed divinity? There are hundreds of them. And in this country, we have thousands of men who have claimed divinity. He's not the only one. But Rajneesh Bhakti said, no, he's unique. Let's go to the next test. Allahu Samad. Allah, the absolute eternal. Was Rajneesh absolute eternal? We know from his biography, from his autobiography, he was suffering from asthma, from diabetes, from chronic backache. Imagine Almighty God suffering from asthma, diabetes, chronic backache. Third test. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not nor is begotten. Bhagwan Rajneesh was born in Madhya Pradesh. He had a father and mother. In 1981, he goes to America, USA, and he takes thousands of Americans for a ride. In the state of Oregon, he starts his center and calls it as Rajneeshpuram, his village. Later on, the American government arrests him and put him behind bar. Rajneesh says, the American government slow poisoned me. Imagine Almighty God being slow poisoned. In 1985, the American government kicks him out of the country, he comes back to India in the same city, Pune, and he goes back to his center, which is now called as Osho Commune. And if you go to the Samadhi of Rajneesh, it is mentioned there on the Samadhi, Bhagwan Rajneesh, Osho, never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. Never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. They forgot to mention in Samadhi, he was not given visas to 21 countries of the world. Almighty God coming in this world to visit the world and requires visas to go to different countries. And the Archbishop of Greece said, if you don't remove Rajneesh out of this country, we'll burn his house and the house of his disciples. And the last test, Walam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad, is so stringent that no one besides the true Almighty God can pass. The moment you can compare God to anything, he's not God. Walam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. We know Rajneesh, like the human beings, had a beard, one nose, two eyes, two ears, two hands. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he's not God. Walam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. If someone says Almighty God is 1,000 times stronger than Arnold Schwarzenegger, might have heard the name of Arnold Schwarzenegger. Have you heard Arnold Schwarzenegger? The person who got the title Mr. World, Mr. Universe. The strongest man in the world, the strongest man in the universe. The moment you can compare God to anyone, whether it be Arnold Schwarzenegger, whether it be Dara Singh, whether it be King Kong, whether it be 1,000 times or 1,000,000 times, the moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he is not God. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There is nothing like him. So this is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given in the Quran. Whichever God you are worshipping, brother, put that God to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If that God passes, that is a true God. Otherwise, it's a fake God.
Let us have a question from the sister's side, please. A non-Muslim sister should come forward and ask a question, please.
Adab, Dr. Zakniya Sahab. My name is Venkatamma. I am a Muslim lady, Sadia Madam, who has been here for many years. My question is, आप बोलते हैं कोई भी मज़हब गलत चीज़ नहीं बताता, गलत काम करने के लिए उत्सुक नहीं करता, और आप क्या वजह है जिसकी वजह से इस्लाम कबूल करने के लिए बोलते हैं तमाम मुस्लिम?
Sister asked the question that she lives with a Muslim for several years. When I said that all the religions speak good things, then why do the Muslims ask me to accept Islam? Point number one. I say that all the religions, most of the things they say are good. But Islam, besides speaking good things, shows you a way how to achieve that goodness. And I give the example, all religion says don't rob. Islam says the same, but Islam shows you a way how to achieve a state in which people will not rob. Give zakat, give charity. After that, someone robs, chop off the hand, there will be no robbery, there will be no crime. So in this way, I try to explain that Islam, besides talking about good things, shows you a way how to achieve that state of goodness. Secondly, if I have to say, being a student of comparative religion, if you have to follow your Hindu scriptures, assuming you're a Hindu, if you have to follow your Hindu scriptures, if you have to be a good Hindu, your Hindu scriptures say, there is one God. I quoted all these verses in my previous answer. One God. Your scripture says, don't do idol worship. Bhagavad Gita chapter number 7, verse number 20. All those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, they worship demigods. They do idol worship. You have to believe in one God. I said in my lecture today that you have to believe in the Antim Rishi, the Kalki Avatar, whose father's name will be Vishnu Yash Abdullah. Mother's name shall be Sumati Amina, who will be born in the village of Sambala, Makkah, who will be born to the chief of the village of Sambala, chief of Makkah. He will be a messenger for the whole of humankind. He will get enlightenment at night in a cave. He will go northwards and come back. He will be given 8 qualities. He will be a messenger for the whole of humankind. He will ride a horse. He will have a sword in the right hand. He will have 4 companions. He will be helped by the angels and devatas. On and on and on. Who is this person? If you are a good Hindu, you have to believe in the Antim Rishi. Otherwise, you're not a good Hindu. If you are a good Hindu, you have to believe in one God. You don't have to do idol worship. Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima. There is no idol. There is no image. There is no photograph. There is no sculpture. And I have had dialogues with pandits of Hinduism. With Shankaracharya. Many. And I've quoted this. No Shankaracharya told me, Brother Zakir, you're wrong. No one. I had a dialogue with Sri Sri Ravi Shankar on 21st of January. Supposed to be the most popular spiritual guru, Art of Living. I told him, the best book on Art of Living is the glorious Quran. I asked him to join our club of Art of Living. We have 1.3 billion members. 1.3 billion members. I gave him an invitation. If he follows the scriptures, he's supposed to be a scholar of the Vedas, he should come to this. Similarly, sister, when I say that all the other scriptures, even if you agree with the word of God, by the passage of time, they have been changed. Swami Vivekananda says that 99% of the Vedas have been lost. Whatever 1% we have to follow it strictly. Strictly means believe in the Antim Rishi also. So if you follow it strictly, you'll have to believe in Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Have to believe in the Quran. And I give you an invitation, sister, to come to this religion of peace so that you can come closer to Almighty God.
Question from this mic here, please.
It's a great opportunity for this August evening to have a valuable, immortal and moral and religion spiritual lecture, we are all impressed by your way of telling, which is changes the person's attitude. My highest regard, my name is Ramdas, I am person officer from electricity board. So I got highest regard for Islam. Being a Hindu, I got a highest Islam. I agree with you, just now you said that Hinduism never speaks of idol worship. It's unfortunate Hinduism are being misguided by egoistic thoughts of the religious so-called leaders. They are deliberately misleading the people. In the same Hindus, they say 90% of the Hindus are being misguided, saying that idol worship, Vedas, Upanishads never speaks about idol worship. It is only the Ruh. The Ruh is the criteria. Ruh Khuda ki inayat hai. Wo Ruh ko Christianity mein soul kehte hain, Islam mein Ruh, Hindus mein Atma. It's very unfortunate. The egoistic attitude of the takedas of all religious, whether it is a Muslim, Christianity, or Hindus, they are the egoistic fellows who misguide the humanity, people in general, all over the world. Now, my question before you, my beloved, learned intellectual person, is at the just now, Mr. Diwan of the Delhi has rightly pointed out that Islam is a glorious past. At every stage. But unfortunately, Islam has come to the laughable stock in the present days of the world. The reason is the takedas of the Muslims leaders, like Hindu leaders, they are making ruhani ko pachane mein ande jaisa jee rahe hai. Ye dil ki aankhe khol khuda ki noor hi noor hai. Mar insaan anda ban ke jee raha hai. Kya ye sawal bol sakte hai ki suraj एक है, हवा को कुछ मज़हब नहीं है, पानी को कुछ मज़हब नहीं है, एक हिंदू भाई एक मुसलमान औरत को नहीं खून देता है औरत जी सकती हैं, तो खून जब खून ब्लड अगर दे दिए एक हिंदू और मुसलमान औरत को दिए तो नहीं, उन्होंने जान बच गई है, क्या है हो सकता है कि ये हिंदू ये मुसलमानों को दिए तो इन्हों इस्लाम बन गया? दैट्स द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन, प्लीज ट्राई टू आई एम एनालाइजिंग माई क्वेश्चन. सेकेंडली, खून देने से उन्हें बच जाती हैं, तो उन्होंने दिल की दुआ दी थी, आ मेरा बेटा, मेरा जान बचा है, मेरे बेटा ये पॉजिटिव वो पॉजिटिव इज द बी पॉजिटिव इज द ब्लड. सो मुसलमान औरत को उसके औलाद का खून नहीं आता है, तो इसको बैस के से इंसानियत की पहली चीज़ है, इंसान एक मज़हब है. सो उन्होंने बी ग्रुप सगा बेटा का खून टैली नहीं हुआ, तो इनो हिंदू ने टैली हुआ दे दिया, वो माँ बोलते हैं, उस माँ के वास्ते क्या मज़हब की ज़रूरत नहीं है? दिस इज फर्स्ट वन. इसीलिए आज इंसान नहीं रूहानी को नहीं पहचान रहे, आंखें रह के भी अंधे के जैसे जी रहे, दिल की आंखें खोले तो खुदा की नूर, खुदा को नूर पहचानने में नहीं एक अहम आ रहा है, मज़हब आ रहा है, नफरत की आग में जी रहे. इस्लाम से इसे मोहब्बत फातह आलम असलम सलाम सब उन्होंने मोहब्बत, इसलिए सदियों के सालों का हज़ारों साल के बाद भी नहीं उनकी मोहब्बत फालियाम से नहीं हर चीज दिस जक़ात है. जस जक़ात इज ए गुड इन इस्लाम, चैरिटी हेल्प बीइंग फेलो बीइंग. किसी की गरीबी की शादी है तो उसको शादी करो, उसकी हज हो जाता है. तो इस्लाम का सच्चे वर्चुस विच नो रिलीजन गॉट इज इट, वी अग्री फॉर इट, आई टू अग्री हाइट इट, इट्स अ वेरी नाइस वर्चुस. अनफॉर्चुनेटली देर इज नो इम्प्लीमेंटेशन इन द रियल लाइफ. So Mr. Diwan said the mothers are to be transparent. Let the Hindus might be needed. Ki khuda ki inayat ko pehchanne mein nahi aaj Islam barbaad ho raha hai. Christianity egoism, they want to supreme purpose, they want to curtail the Islam. That is the egoistic attitude of Christianity. Hinduism, they want for the existence. No, so these are all the takedas. They are not finding what is Ruh. Ruh khuda ki inayat hai, Upanishad mein hai, Islam mein hai, aur Bible mein jaise. सो इस रूह को पहचानने में नहीं अन्य के जैसे दे रहे, वही रूहानी को नहीं पहचान रहे. सो इंसान जिंदा अल्लाह का जैसा जीना पसंद करे. क्या इस्लाम में मदरसा में नहीं रूह मोहब्बत फातिम सीखे तो नहीं, इस दुनिया में नहीं एक आयम खाम नहीं मोहब्बत फातिम, वर्ल्ड इज वर्ल्ड रिलीजन ऑफ मोहब्बत इस्लाम हो सकता है? दिस इज माई फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन. सेकेंड क्वेश्चन आई एम दिस इज माई फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन, रूहानी को नहीं पहचान रहे. सेकेंड क्वेश्चन इज, क्या औरत को नहीं एक बुरी निगाह से देखना हिंदुइज्म में है? हिंदुज़म में औरत को बुरा निगाह से देखे हैं, इस्लाम में बुरा निगाह से देख रहे हैं, क्रिश्चियनिटी में देख, क्या औरत से दुनिया बदली? अभी जस्ट यू सेड टू ए यंग मैन दैट मर्द को बच्चा पैदा हो सकता है या नहीं? नो, मैन कैन नॉट गिव बर्थ टू ए जेन, इट इज़ द मदर, इट इज़ अ लेडी विच गिव्स बर्थ टू, द वर्ल्ड स्टार्ट्स विद लेड, औरत ने जन्म दिया मर्द को, मर्द उसे बाजार दे रहा है, चाहे हिंदू हो, क्रिश्चियन हो, मुस्लिम, इस्लाम हो। सो आज इतनी हर मजहब नहीं बर्बादी के ओर चल रहा है, इसको बोलते हैं दो कलयुग बोले बिना कल की अवतार बोलते हैं। सो ऑल डूम्स डे इन क्रिश्चियनिटी, इन कलयुग में ख़त्म होने के दिन, उर्दू में नहीं खयामत के दिन है, ये खयामत के दिन में नहीं, औरत को ने औरत ना एक पवित्रता था नहीं समझे। सो एक ही अय्याशी की कानूनी अय्याशी से कर रहे, हर मजहब वैसी औरत को बुरी निगाह से देख रहे हैं। और दिस इज सेकेंड क्वेश्चन, क्या इस्लाम ये जो खयामत के दिन या कलयुग के दिन या डूम्स डे में नहीं, क्या इस्लाम में इस चीज़ को क्या कबूल दे सकती है? इसलिए मदरसा में नहीं, औरत को नहीं, मोहब्बत फात आलम माँ का जैसा दुनिया बनती है, रूहानी को पहचानो, मोहब्बत करो, कानूनी अय्याशी को बंद करो, सेकेंड क्वेश्चन, फर्स्ट ही रूहानी को नहीं पहचान रहे। सो ये अंधा इंसान नहीं, जिंदा रह के भी नहीं, अंधे के जैसा कई को जी रहे, मोहब्बत फाते आलम रूहानी।
I'll answer your question, brother. You have asked a question. I've got your question, brother. Thank you for your...
That you will give, that I am writing a book, Khuda ki inayat ko pehchano. I am writing to a question to the world, all religious, Khuda ki inayat ko pehchano. Why this wars?
Thank you, brother, for a very short speech. And thank you for the good words. You spoke about me and about Islam. As far as I am concerned, all praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. You called me a scholar, you called me a knowledgeable person. I am just a student. I consider myself to be a student on Islam and comparative religion. You posed two questions, one on Ruh and then on women. Before that, you made certain statement. You said that most of the religious thekedar are causing problems. Majority, I do agree with you. Then you also went and said that Islam is being maligned because the religious leaders of Islam, they are causing a bad name for Islam. As far as the religious leaders of the other communities, they prevent their followers to read the scripture and do research. As far as Islam is concerned as a whole, I don't blame the religious scholars of Islam, the religious leaders. There are a few black sheep, very few. There are a very small number of so-called religious scholars who are misleading, but they are a very small percentage. The media picks them up and portrays as though every Islamic religious scholar is like that. Therefore, as far as Islamic religious scholars are concerned, ulamas are concerned, we love them, we respect them. There are a few people, a very small percentage, who do take advantage and misguide the people, but as a whole, alhamdulillah, they speak the good things, they talk about the religion, we love them, we respect them. In contrast to other religions, most of the other religious readers of the other religions, they don't do that. They prevent the followers from reading the scriptures. Like you rightly said, Hinduism condemns idol worship, etc. But more than 90% are doing idol worship because they don't want their followers to read the scriptures. Coming to your question, you said that if a Hindu gives up blood to a Muslim, the Muslim's life is saved. Main thing is Rouhani. So where is the mazhab? Does the person become a Hindu? Or if a Muslim gives blood to a Hindu, does he become a Muslim? Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, if anyone saves any other human being, if any person, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, saves any other human being, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, it is as though he has saved the whole of humanity. So if any human being gives up blood to any other human being and saves a life, whether Muslim gives to a Hindu or a Hindu gives to a Muslim, that person has saved the whole of humanity. The ayat further says, if anyone kills any other human being, unless it be for murder or for creating corruption in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. But saving a life of a human being is very good. It's a good deed, very high deed. But the earlier question posed was, why has God created us? I told you earlier, Allah says in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 2, Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It is Allah who has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. Saving someone's life is a very great deed. But saving someone's akhirah
Next life is a bigger deal. That's the reason I was a doctor, supposed to be the best profession, saving human lives. I chose to be a doctor because I thought it was the most noblest profession. It is. But I found a nobler profession. Allah says in Surah Fussilat, chapter number 41, verse number 33, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech than one who invites people to the way of their Lord, who does righteous deeds, and says that I am the one who submit my will to Almighty God. So I changed from being a doctor of a body to a doctor of a soul, which is a better profession. So giving someone blood and saving his life is good, but giving someone the truth and saving his akhirah is better. He said that let's follow what is common. So all religions speak about Prophet Muhammad. So Quran speaks about Prophet Muhammad. So what is unique? Very good question. All the other religions say that there will be a prophet to come later on, as the Bible says, you being a Christian and a student of the Bible, I believe, in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to tell you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, all that he hears shall he say. He shall show you things to come. He shall glorify me. That means all the scripture, Hindu scripture, Parsi scripture, Buddhist scripture, Jewish scripture, Christian scriptures, talking about a prophet to come, a prophet to come, a prophet to come. But Quran says, this is the prophet on whom the Quran is revealed. The prophet has come. When you study standard 1 in the school, the ultimate is standard 10. When you go to standard 2, ultimate is standard 10. When you go to standard 3, standard 10 is ultimate, as far as the school is concerned. Standard 5, standard 6, standard 7, standard 8, standard 9. Now you reach standard 10 and then you give the SSC examination, correct? That doesn't mean what you learn in standard 1 is the same in standard 10. You are getting prepared for standard 10. So once you are prepared, 1400 years ago, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, as Jesus Christ said, I have many things to say unto you. He cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. So 1400 years back, Almighty God, our Creator, thought it fit. Now the human beings can take this final message. That is the Quran. In all the other scriptures, the basic message of Tawheed, the oneness of God, is the same. The minute details may differ. All the scriptures say about one God. You have to believe in prophets and the final prophet Muhammad. But the basics is the same. The details may differ. But Allah says in Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse number 3, on this day have I perfected my religion for you, have chosen for you Islam and perfected my favor on you, that is the humankind. After the Quran has been revealed, nothing new can be added, nothing can be subtracted. As I mentioned earlier, if there's something like the Old Testament and the New Testament, the glorious Quran is the last testament. So what is different is, this tells you the ultimate version, the final testament of Almighty God. So if there's an Old Testament and New Testament, the glorious Quran is the last testament. All these religions, they're pointing finger to the same book, the glorious Quran, the same messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Other religions speak about Prophet Muhammad to come. Islam teaches you what Allah has revealed on Prophet Muhammad and what has he mentioned in the Hadith. So this is the final culmination for the whole of humankind. From Adam alayhi salam, Adam, peace be upon him, till the last day, till today and till the last day. All of these are talking about that same one God, talking about the last messenger to come. So finally, they have to accept it. And you have to accept the message and implement it. Then only will you be a true Christian. Therefore, I say, I've given a talk on similarities between Islam and Christianity. And I've proved that we Muslims are more Christian than the Christians themselves. Because if we analyze, we follow more teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, than the Christians themselves. You can refer to my video cassette, Similarities Between Islam and Christianity.
Question from the sister section, please.
Brother, I am Susan and I am a Bible student, and my question is, in your lecture you said that about the death of the prophets, and in that Moses and Muhammad are of a natural death. And I came across the Quran that Muhammad was given poison from one of his wife, and she gives in such a way that if he is a right prophet, he must be able to discern that he's been given that poison.
Sister said that I said Prophet Muhammad that the natural death, peace be upon him, but she knows that the Quran mentioned that one of his wives gave poison. Sister, here is the Quran. I challenge you to show any verse in the Quran which says that one of his wives gave poison. Nowhere does the Quran say one of his wives gave poison. There's no such verse like that. Maybe where you're getting this from, check your source. Whoever has told you, ask him for proof. See, whatever I said, sister, I gave references. Chapter number, verse number, chapter number, verse number, chapter number, verse number. I quoted the name of Prophet Muhammad in the Vedas. I can again repeat. In Hindu scriptures, Christian scriptures, I gave references. Why? So that you can go home and check. If you think I'm pulling a fast one, you can go and check. Where is the reference? I challenge you to show me in anywhere in the Quran, in any one of the 114 surahs, nowhere it is mentioned, someone is misleading you, sister. Hope that answers the question.
Question from the mic here, please.
My name is Vinay Kumar. I am an artist. I am a painter. And I want to ask one question, that in your website you give two reasons why Muhammad could not have copied from the Holy Bible or from the other pre-existing sources. So you gave answer that you claim that there were no Arabic translations of the Bible during the time of Muhammad. But in Sahih al-Bukhari, volume number 6 and book number 60, number 478, it says that the gospel has already been translated into Arabic by Waraka. And also second thing is, you said Muhammad was illiterate and therefore couldn't have read books such as the Holy Bible. But I'm not satisfied with that answer, because it wasn't necessary for Muhammad to be literate in order to borrow stories from previous scriptures. Muhammad only needed to hear these stories orally for borrowing to take place. After hearing these stories, Muhammad revised then, and he wrote the theological pre-assumptions and then tried to pass them off as revelation from God.
The brother asked a very good question. He goes to the website, so I'm happy about that. Inshallah, he'll come to the truth. And I believe you're a Christian. Your name is Vinay Kumar. You're a Christian, I believe. And brother said, I give two reasons on my website. Not two, I've given several. You have picked up two. I'll come to it. Because then you have to read in context. These are not the only two reasons. These are two of the many reasons I gave. And one of the reasons I gave that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam an ummi. As Allah says in the Quran in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 48, that we have made the last prophet as an ummi, so that the blabberers will not use that as a pretext. You have to agree that between a literate and illiterate, it is more difficult for illiterate. You have to agree that. Do you agree or not? More difficult. More difficult. If a person who's literate, for him to copy is much more easier. He can hear also and read also. For a person who's illiterate, he can only hear. So at least you have to agree with me for sake of argument. It is difficult. Do you agree? Yes, God, mashallah. So these are points I'm mentioning many. This is not the only one point. Amongst the many points, this is one of them. All the others follow. Point number two, you mentioned, I said that no Arabic version of the Bible was present, and I agree with it yet. You quoted Sahih Bukhari, volume number 6, that Waraka, yes, he had knowledge about the gospel. Nowhere does it say that he translated. Brother, I challenge you. I challenge you. According to Christian sources, the first time the Bible was written was in the 10th century. That means the Christian scholars don't know their homework. The first Arabic version of the Bible came much hundreds of years after Prophet Muhammad. Yes, Waraka, coming from the Bani Israel, he had knowledge of the scriptures and knew Arabic. Saying that he has translated, he may have written some notes, but translated the full Bible, impossible. Nowhere does Sahih Bukhari say that Waraka translated the full Bible. I challenge you. It may say that Waraka had knowledge of the law and the gospel. May have written some notes. If, you know Salman Rushdie's book. Salman Rushdie's book also has verses of the Quran. I can't call it the Quran, but Salman Rushdie wrote a book against the Quran. In that book, there are some verses of the Quran. That does not mean that is the Quran. There are other people like I write a book. I mentioned certain verses of the Quran in my book, Quran Modern Science, Similarity Islam Hindu. That book is not the Quran. You cannot say Dr. Zakir Naik translated the Quran. Just because if you go on the website and see, Dr. Zakir Naik wrote a book, Quran Modern Science, and I've quoted about 150 verses. You cannot say that. It is some. And furthermore, you said Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, wrote down and corrected. Okay, that's a very good point. Now, I have given a talk on Bible and Quran in the light of science. And I've proved there are so many scientific errors in the Bible. For example, in the book of Genesis, chapter number 1 itself, it says that the world was created in 624 days. It says the light of the moon is its own light. Genesis chapter number 1, verse number 6 to 19. It says that the sun was created after the earth. Earth was created on third day, sun on the fourth day. I can go on and on. So do you mean to say Prophet Muhammad took this and changed it? The light of the moon is not its own light, it's a reflected light. Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse 61, that the light of the moon is reflected light. Quran says the world was created in six ayam, six long period. So you mean to say Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam picked up all these things and corrected? Do you think you're the scientist? No, it was a revelation from God. So go for my full talk, just quoting part of my talk, and as though like you will say that I will. You hear my full talk. And then I said that even if I agree, he copied from the Bible for sake of argument and then corrected. Is it possible for a human being 1400 years back to correct all the scientific errors? Means what is wrong, he corrected. It's impossible. Impossible. So this proves that it was not his work. It was the work of the Creator, Almighty God. Hope that answers the question.
Question from the center mic, please.
Yes, sir. My name is N. Ravishekar or Sridhar Reddy, sir. I'm principal of BED College. But I studied different religions, sir, including Bible and Quran, Hadith and all these things. And I have been trying to know truth. And I learned namaz and I was doing. Sir, in one of the Hadith, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asks a Syrian not to divulge his faith and say, La ilaha illallah. The times were such. But nowadays, because it is the Darul Harab disease, our psychological implications and also social implications and other things or past, is there any concession for people who want to follow Islam? And also some of the things given by Tao of Physics by Fidget Capra and Stephen Hawking's History of Time, there are so many galaxies and other things, and we cannot brush aside some of the concepts like Anal Haq or Aham Brahmasmi. Doing five times namaz, or even tawhid, can we in our rest time follow this concept of Anal Haq? And as some of the people
were telling... Please pose one question at a time, we have lack of time, and answer your question. The other people waking on the microphone. The brother asked a question that he knows of a hadith that Prophet told a Syrian not to change his faith. Not to?
Not to say, La ilaha illallah aloud in the bazaar. He was beaten.
The brother has said that Prophet Muhammad said, don't say La ilaha illallah loudly in the bazaar, he was beaten. I don't know which hadith you're quoting in context. There's a hadith which says that don't say Allahu Akbar loudly. Not La ilaha illallah. That is a hadith because in the war, when they're hiding and the enemy is coming, don't say Allahu Akbar loudly, because that means you'll be exposed, not in the bazaar, in the battlefield. The other hadith says, say loudly so that it will encourage the other soldiers. So it depends upon the situation. He does one of the person in the battlefield, say Allahu Akbar. It gives the jazba, the passion, the love. But certain times when you're hiding, if you say loudly, then you'll be exposed. So depending upon different situation, different things are there. Your main question was that can we follow Islam and other things like Socrates or some other people or from other scientists, including Anwar Haq. As far as following anything else with Islam, if it doesn't go against the Quran and the Sahih Hadith, no problem. If it matches with the Quran and Sahih Hadith, it should be followed. If anything else, whether X, Y or Z, whether science, geography, history, whether Hinduism, Christianity, Judaism, say something which is also mentioned in the Quran, it becomes the fard for you to follow. If it says something which is not mentioned in the Quran and does not go against the Quran, you can follow it, mubah, optional. But if it says something which is against the Quran, it is haram, it is prohibited. Three different strategies, three different ways. Regarding a question, Islam believes in Tawheed, five times Salah. Does it believe in Anwalhaq? Anwalhaq, becoming one with God, it is shirk. It is against Tawheed. You can't say, I believe in Tawheed, and you believe in more than one God. You believe in Tawheed and saying, I will become one with God. It is opposite. So anyone who believes in that, becoming one with God, he cannot be a follower of Tawheed. He cannot be Muhaid. It's two opposite things. But other things which matches with the Quran, no problem. Which doesn't go against the Quran, no problem. Hope that answers the question.
Question from a non-Muslim sister.
A pleasure. Good evening to everyone here. I'm V. Lakshmi Iyer. So I'm a Hindu and truly believe in Islam. I believe in Islam because I have got some proof from it. So when you said God is one, religion is one, let me take an example of three people, a Hindu, a Muslim, and a Christian. Let me take them together, and if their bodies, if suppose their bodies are cut down, what oozes from their body? Only blood, and it's only blood. Not the milk, not the water, it's only the blood. When you cut down, only the blood oozes. Why do we differentiate when we depart the body? The Muslims go with burying, and we Hindus, we go by lighting the pyre.
The sister says that she appreciates Islam, she believes in Islam, and I congratulate you and I welcome you to the faith of Islam, submitting our will to Almighty God. The question asked by the sister is that a Hindu, Christian, and a Muslim all have got the same body, same blood, same constituent. But when we die, why in Hinduism do we burn the body? Why in Islam do we bury? Let's analyze the pros and cons, and you decide which is better. In Hinduism, also they say you can bury the children, etc. But when you become an adult, most of the sects say you have to burn, you have to cremate. There are some sects which say you have to bury. But let's analyze the pros and cons between cremation, that is burning, and burial. If we analyze, in Islam, we have to bury. Why? Because today we have come to know that whatever constituents of the body is there, the earth, the soil, contains the same basic elements of the body in lesser or greater proportion. So from earth we come, and to earth we return. Scientific. Comparison, point number one. In cremation, we burn the body, there is pollution. In Islam, when we bury, the land becomes fertile. There's no pollution, there's no burning. Point number two, when you burn, you chop down the trees. Greenery goes down. Environment is being uprooted. In Islam, when we bury, land becomes fertile, more trees grow. It becomes a manure. No chopping down of the trees. Better for the environment. You know, the government says, don't chop trees. If you don't chop trees, how will you burn the human body? Point number three, it is more expensive. According to Indian statistics, every year, crores and crores and crores, hundreds and thousands of crores, every day crores of rupees are spent. Every year, hundreds of crores are being spent only on the trees and burning the body. In Islam, when we bury, it is cheap, free. Point number five, when we burn, the wood becomes charcoal, ashes. In Islam, once we bury in the land, the same land can be used after a few years. It is forever. You can recycle it. The same land, after a few years, when the bones get disintegrated, you can recycle. So logically and scientifically, if we analyze, it is more scientific, more humane, more better for burial as compared for cremation. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Yes, brother, please announce your name first.
Assalamu alaikum, my name is Mayur. I have to ask a question on behalf of my non-Muslim friend. It's not my question. He's feeling shy to come on mic, so can I go ahead?
What is your name, you said?
Mayur. I am a revert, but it's a question on behalf of my non-Muslim friend. He doesn't want to come on mic, so if you allow. Okay. Assalamu alaikum to all of you. His question is, all the prophecies that Zakir Bhai quoted, Is it possible that these prophecies were being edited later on in all the various scriptures of the world to preach Islam in a other way? So,
the brother asked a very good question. Can it be possible that all these prophecies were added in all the scriptures later on? Can it be? Yes, it can be. If it is not added, if the scripture is pure, you have to believe it to be the word of God. You have to follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If you say it is added, that means the scripture is corrupted. You leave your scripture aside. So if you leave your scripture aside, the only pure scripture is the Quran. Both ways you come to the Quran, heads I win, tails you lose.
Question from the center mic, please.
Okay, good evening. I have one question. Before that, my name is Mr. M. Ramesh Kumar. I am from Nayapul. My profession is pastor. So brother, in this occasion, you are told the final is Quran. Okay, but I have one question. In a bottle of Yamama, may people died. These who bayhated the Quran, there was a few that Quran can be lost during the Abu Bakr time. And second, Sahih al-Bukhari volume 6, hadith number 510 says, but when three caliphs, third caliph came, he was fighting with Harimiya people, and that time this found all the way reading a different Qurans. So Usman reading. And another thing is, Allah says in Quran 15:9, says we have released and we got it, but here the Quran was born, and at the time what was the corrupted, why it was the corrupted, where it was the corrupted, who is what the corrupted, when it was the corrupted, please answer me.
Brother asked the question. He says, when the Quran says in Surah Hijr chapter 15 verse number 9, which I quoted in my talk, that we have revealed the Quran and we shall guard from corruption. So when the Quran says the Quran is uncorrupted, Allah says it's unadulterated, how come Sahih Bukhari says that the Quran was lost at Abu Bakr's time, then third Khalifa Hazrat Usman came and he found different readings, and then how is it possible? Brother, what you said of Sahih Bukhari is correct. What Hazrat Usman, may Allah be pleased with him, found is variant reading. For example, in English language, there are different dialects. Same English language, a South Indian speaks different. What is your name? An Englishman, what is your name? So Hyderabadi has a different accent. I can't imitate it. Hindi style is different. My wife was telling me, why don't you speak Hyderabadi style Urdu yesterday? Nakko. In Bombay, we don't say nakko. In Bombay, we say aayenga, jayenga, khayenga, piyenga. So one of my Bombay brothers said, aayenga, gayenga was less yesterday. So here you realize that every area has a different dialect. So same way at the time of Hazrat Usman, in Arabic, may Allah be pleased with him, there were different dialects. What the Prophet gave permission was seven dialects. So in pronunciation, they made mistakes. So when they made mistakes, he said, okay, let's finalize it. And we have to follow the correct pronunciation. So one of the reasons he did was he corrected the dialect. If someone says, what is your name? An Englishman will say, what type of English is this? What is your name? What's your name? American accent is different. British accent is different. Neutral accent is different. Some accept it, some are not. This was one of the reasons. He corrected the dialect. Number two, when Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when the Quran was revealed, he had special scribes. And he told the special sahabas, whatever was revealed to him, he repeated it. And the sahabas wrote down, he rechecked it. In that, Zayd bin Thabit, may Allah be pleased with him, he was the main person, and other scribes. Now, many of the sahabas, when Prophet Muhammad said the Quran, they went home and wrote it through memory. So now someone hears my speech and goes home and makes points. It may be right, may be wrong. It will not be verbatim. But if I tell someone and check up, okay, I'm giving notes, write this, read it again, it's a mistake, correct it. So the copy that was kept with Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was verified by him when he was alive. It was given to his wife, Hazrat Hafsa, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the daughter of Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him. So it was kept in that custody. Now when people wrote on their own from their memory, there are bound to be mistakes. So the Quran is not wrong. Even though there were notes of some people, Hazrat Usman said, now people should not get misled that that is the real Quran. So he said, okay, now I'll make copies of this and spread it throughout different parts of the world so that they will know this is the authentic. The Quran wasn't changed. People, when they had their own notes written down, people did not know whether that was 100% verbatim correct or not. So Hazrat Usman, the third Khalifa, may Allah be pleased with him, he saw to it that he made a committee of the Sahabas and copied it from the original copy and spread it in different parts of the world. And one of them is even present in Tashkent in Koptaki Museum today. And if you analyze it, it is verbatim same. And today the Huffaz, even if you burn all the copies, today there are millions of Huffaz who know the Quran by heart. Even if you burn all the copies, hypothetically, yet if these people get together, they can again make the true verbatim Quran. Hope that answers the question.
Any non-Muslim sister?
Good evening to everybody. I'm Mrs. Sutapa Sarkar. I'm a teacher by profession. With due respect, sir, I wish to ask you a question. How is karma and moksha defined in Islam? And how is it indifferent while in practice?
Sister asked a question that how is karma and moksha defined in Islam? Karma, sister, in the Hindu scriptures means deed. The deed that you do, action, it should be followed according to dharma. And the Hindu scholars, they believe in a philosophy known as samskara, the cycle of birth, and death, known as reincarnation or the theory of transmigration of soul. And they believe that whatever karma you do, if you do good deeds, in the next life you'll be born of a higher level. If you do bad deeds, in the next life you'll be born of a lower level. If you do good deeds, you'll be born like a human being. If bad deeds, maybe like an animal, like a rat, like a cat, or like a cockroach. And only if there are no things, there are no balance of good or bad, then you get moksha from the cycle of samskara, birth and death. This is the philosophy of the Hindu scholars. But this is nowhere mentioned in the Veda, is nowhere mentioned in the Vedas, the highest authorities. They do try and derive it from Bhagavad Gita, which is mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 2, verse number 22, that like a body changes clothes and puts on new clothes, same way a soul puts on a new body. In the Hindu scriptures, there's a mention of Punarjanam in the Vedas. Book number 10, hymn number 16, verse number 4-5. Punar means next, Janam means life. Next life. We believe in next life. We believe we came in this world once. We'll only come once. We were alive before. Allah caused us to die. We came in this world. Again we'll die. Again we'll be resurrected in the next world. So we believe in this world. Islam believe we'll come once. And then we'll be resurrected, raised up alive in the next hereafter. Depending upon the good and bad deeds, you'll go to hell or heaven, swarga narak. This is what the Vedas say. But they could not realize, the Hindu scholars, that how come some people are born deaf, some people blind, some people poor, some people rich, some people healthy. So God cannot do injustice. So they came up with this philosophy of cycle of birth, death, transmigration of soul, which is nowhere mentioned in the Veda. Even Bhagavad Gita, when it says, you throw away your old clothes and put new clothes, same way the soul throws away the body and puts a new body, once, I've got no objection. Once you die, again you're resurrected. But Islam has a reply for the query. Because the Hindu scholars could not agree that how can God be unjust? Some people born deaf, some people healthy, some people with heart disease, some people rich, some people poor. Islam believes, Allah says in Surah Mulk, chapter number 16, verse number 2, Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It is Allah who has given death and life to test which of you is good indeed. So this life is a test for the hereafter. Now some people are born rich, some people are born poor. The rich people, the Quran says, you have to give zakat. Whatever saving you have, more than the 85 grams of gold, more than nisab, 2.5% zakat every lunar you have to give. The rich person may give, may not give. He may give half. He may get 100% marks, may get 50%. If he doesn't give, he'll get zero. For the poor man, he doesn't have to give zakat. He gets 100 out of 100 in zakat. We tere gareeb insaan hai. Gareeb kya usko 100 out of 100 mila zakat mein. In zakat, Therefore, Prophet said, it is easier for a poor man to go to Jannah than a rich man. The rich man will say, oh, I don't have to give so much zakat, I may have to give, I may not have to give. If he's the best, maximum will get 100 out of 100. For the poor man, already full marks. So everyone is tested in different ways. Some people are born healthy, some people are born with congenital heart defects. We don't believe he's born with a disease because he sinned in the last life. It's a test for the hereafter. Not that he had sinned. Maybe it's a test for the parents. Allah says in Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse number 28, your wealth and your children are a test for you. Maybe Allah wants to test the parents. They are very pious. And he gives birth to children who have congenital heart disease. Someone will say, oh, I don't believe in God. Those are very good parents may say, yet I believe in God. Allah is testing. The greater the test, the higher the reward. Maybe Allah wants to give them Jannat-e-Firdaus. Like if you pass a graduation, you get a BA or a BSc or a BCom. If you pass MBBS, you get doctor. Difficult to pass MBBS than normal BA. But difficult the test, higher the degree. So we believe no one is born sinful. Everyone is born masoom. But in the Hindu philosophy of the scholars, not of the scripture, they believe that you come in this world again and again. If you do good deeds as a human being, bad deeds as a lower being, this the Vedas never believe. And furthermore, logically, if you analyze today, sister, the crime is increasing or decreasing? Increasing or decreasing? Crime is increasing or decreasing? Increasing. Is the population of human beings increasing or decreasing? Increasing. So logically, if the crime is increasing, the human population should decrease. It is not. So that proves that this philosophy is wrong. And furthermore, refer to my video cassette, Similarities Between Hinduism and Islam, for more details on the subject.
Since we are coming to the close, I would request one short question, and I would request the speaker also to give a short reply. Please come.
My profession is training in yoga and public speaking skills. I am Chandra Kumar. Yeah, good evening, my dear soul friend, J.K. Naik. Just one thing. I am basically Hindu, and I have equal respect for all other systems also. And I could learn some techniques of Christianity and Islam from my father also. Fine. So I would like to know from you. And in other systems, all are not universal, only for particular community and particular segment. Islam, but the Quran is for, you are telling Surya Subha 24-20 or some difference for universal thing. Fine. The crisp of the Vedic, I mean, to the best of my knowledge, it is Sarve Janaha Sukhino Bhavantu. Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha, it says. But it doesn't say Sarve Hindu Sukhinaha, Sarve Hindu Sukhinaha. No, it is all the human beings should be merciful, happy, and pleasant. It is one thing. And another thing, whatever the you are describing for Allah in Surah Ikhlas, Kul huwa Allahu ahad Allahu samad lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Like that, in our Vedas also, verses 24 to 28, Samadhipata of Yoga, it is describing Klesa Karma Vipaka Asayahi Abaramrushnaha Purusha Visheshaha Yishvaraha Tatra Niratisayam Sarvajna Bijam Sarveshama Api Guruhu Kalena Aravachedat Tasya Vachakaha Pranavaha. He has not given to any birth to not any person. He was not born to any person. And he is superior to even five basic elements. And he is at all the times omnipresent. That is Ishvara. Whatever the Allah, you have given, it is appealing to the same Ishvara, what we call. And in Bhagavad Gita, since you know, Sloka 31 of chapter 3, I mean, Karma Yoga, it says, ete matamidam, for manavaha, shraddhavayo, anasuyatom, mucchente api karma bihi. What he says, whoever follows my religion, all the human beings, Lord Krishna says, not only the Hindus who follow, all the human beings who follows my words of Bhagavad Gita, I am with them. That is the thing. And to the best of my mind, I don't know that surah you say. Miyamala
Miskala Zarvatina. We are getting late. You already asked three questions already. Please. You have asked one question. The police is saying the time is up. We have to respect the law. Otherwise, they say I'm not a good Muslim. I got the chit that I have to end by 10:30. 10:30 is already up. I'll just try and reply in brief. All these questions answered on the website. You can go to my video cassettes. I'll give you a copy of Similarity with Islam and Hinduism. The brother said, an answer in short, for more details, refer to my other cassettes. The brother said that even Hinduism says that sukh for all of humanity. Brother, I said that whenever the scriptures came, It came for that time and for those people. That means sukh for whole of humanity of that time. Of that time. Not till eternity. Otherwise, your Hindu scripture wouldn't have said there is a rishi to come. If everything was mentioned in the Vedas, why will the Vedas say antim rishi will come for what? If the Vedas mention all the truth, why will they say one more rishi going to come for what? So this proves that the Veda did say about human being, but for that time. It doesn't say it for the whole of humanity forever. So all the scriptures, when they say another rishi is going to come, that means he's going to come to say something else. In the Quran, it says Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger. After him, no one will come. If anyone says, I get a wahi, I get a revelation, today he requires a psychiatrist. Messengership is over. Coming to your other question, you said that your Vedas, your second and third question, your Vedas said God is one, you should not worship him, etc. I agree with it. That's what I said, Kulvallavad. So what is the question? But do you worship such a God? You said you believe in Kulvallavad, God is one, who is not begotten, who has got no image, there's nothing like him. So I'm asking you, yes, I believe in that. Do you believe in such a God? So the moment you give an idol to God, that means it is going against your Veda. And as I mentioned earlier, it's clearly mentioned in the Svetasatara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, and Yajurveda, chapter number 32, verse number 3, Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima, there is no statue, there is no idol, there is no image, there is no photograph, there is no sculpture. You believe this and worship such a God, like the four criteria of Surah Ikhlas, then you're worshipping the true God, otherwise it's a false God. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Salam.